Good morning and welcome to the 30th meeting in 2015 of the Finance Committee of the Scottish Parliament. Can I please remind everyone present to turn off all mobile phones and other electronic devices. Our first item of business today is to decide whether to take item 4 in private. Are members agreed?
Yes.
Members have indicated their agreement. Our second item of business is to take evidence on the devolved taxes from two separate sets of witnesses. Our first panel will focus on the land and buildings transaction tax. I therefore like to welcome to the meeting Kennedy Foster of the Council of Mortgage Lenders, Philip Hogg of Homes for Scotland, and Chris Stewart of the Scottish Property Federation, who was here last week, and another guys. Members have received written submissions from each of our witnesses, so we'll go straight to questions from the committee. And as always, I start with some opening questions, and then we open out the session to colleagues round the table. So, in no particular order, which report will I start with? Well, let's start with your own, Philip. Basically, you've expressed some concerns in terms of your own submission, in terms of the impact of the rates and bans. You've said that the changes have given small benefit to majority of people purchasing a new home and allowed for a smoother pattern of prices in the market instead of having an artificial step at the quarter of a million mark. But then you go on to say that the revised rates are having an adverse effect on the sale of properties in the middle to high end of the market, although this is, of course, based primarily at this stage on anecdotal evidence. So I'm just wondering if you can talk to me a bit more about that. And you've said customers have either requested that transaction be brought forward to before April, delayed until after the introduction of LBTT. So I just wonder if you can not only talk me through that, but also about the scale of the delays, etc., the transactions brought forward, okay, as you understand them.
Thank you. Good morning. Yes, I recall sitting in front of this committee. I think it was back in January, February time when the rates were just announced, and I think at that stage the feedback we'd had from our members was concern that the rates on the higher value end of the market could have the potential to dissuade people from transacting, which would have obviously A, have had an impact on the total tax take, and B, might have caused stagnation. And I think I also recall mentioning the fact that a fully functioning market with movement up and down the chain is absolutely key. The concept of the ladder of people moving upwards and downwards is quite important. The feedback that we've had from our members in advance of this particular meeting has sought just to confirm that. And there's been no comment back from our members that the concerns have not been found. The impact of the tax at the top tier levels, the ones where the higher tax bands come in, has been quite significant. And we're hearing anecdotally a number of our members saying that sales have either been stalled or have not gone through. And we've had feedback, which I've covered off in the report, showing how the the delays of transactions have impacted, and there's some statistics there showing how there was real activity to try and for higher value properties to get their sales completed before the new tax came in, and obviously then a delay afterwards. What we also hear anecdotally is that there's been lots of pressure on developers to help customers to absorb that tax by forms of incentives. Some developers are able to do that, others not. But there's a question about the ongoing viability of that assistance. I think also what we've detected is, particularly in the northeast, a combination of perfect storm conditions. It's well known that the price of oil and gas has tumbled, and that's had an impact on employment in the area, and also an impact on property prices. The market in general. So a combination of the uncertainty in the northeast, the new higher tax bands, and also the loss of Help to Buy has combined together to create a very, very difficult trading conditions in that particular part of the market. I thought this was quite interesting. I saw this extract in the Herald from 2 or 3 weeks back, and I'll just read out something that particularly caught my eye from the editorial on the opening page, where it goes on, well, it starts to say that LBTT is becoming interesting. This week revealed news that business is booming for an upmarket Edinburgh bathroom company, as owners in the £1 million-plus price bracket opt to spruce up their homes rather than move. Now, I'm delighted for the bathroom company, Mr. Ronnie Scott, but what that is, I think, in a nutshell, is sort of brings to life behavioural reaction to the tax. Now, whilst I'm not having, you know, coming forward and saying people in £1 million properties need assistance or whatever, I think what is important is that properties or purchases at that type of level, on the whole, can be largely discretionary. There are probably lots of instances where people don't have to make that move, don't have to make that purchase. And just to sort of show you the impact that might have, let's suppose someone who was considering buying a £750,000 property, but instead decides to have their bathroom upgraded, that loss of tax would require 81 additional sales at £175,000 to make up that tax. So 81 additional sales to stand still because that person decided to have their bathroom upgraded instead. And I think that brings into focus that sort of high dependency on the high tax levels, which we think is not only risky in terms of tax take, but we also think is, you know, shows that we would say disproportionate impact on those higher property levels. And we therefore, I think, going back to our earlier submission of a more smoothing of the tax bands would be far more sensible in terms of the way the tax is allocated.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Philip. Now, Kennedy, in the Council of Mortgage Lenders, you've produced a short but excellent report, basically, on this issue. And it seems actually, in some ways, to contradict a lot of what Philip was saying, not necessarily the high end, but what you've basically said is that there's a 39.2% increase in the number of loans and 27.5% in value in the first quarter of 2015. And within these figures, 8,000 first-time buyer loans, an increase of 50.9% and 5.3% in the first quarter of 2015. Now, I just want to clarify, though, are you talking about the first quarter of the current financial year or the first quarter of the calendar year?
I'm talking about the quarter to the end of 30th of June. In fact, we just announced this morning our lending figures for the quarter to the end of September, and they will show further growth in the mortgage lending market in Scotland. The number of loans granted for house purchase in the quarter to the end of September is 18,500, with a value of 2.4 billion. And as far as first-time buyers are concerned, the number's up to 8,500, and the amount is 920 million. Now, that could be attributed to a number of things. Obviously, the mortgage market at the moment is quite competitive. Obviously, we're still in a very low rate interest environment, and potential interest rate rises look like they're now being held off into 2016. So perhaps there is consumer confidence to take out mortgages at the present moment. I'm not really involved in the day-to-day sale and purchase of houses, but I do, from time to time, speak to estate agents and others, and I would echo what Philip said, that basically at the high end of the market, when you speak to people who are involved in that, there certainly was transactions brought forward to beat the LBTT coming in, and there has been since then, compared to the likes of last year, a much lower level of transactions in the higher end of the market. Whether that will return to more of a norm remains to be seen. If you looked back at the history of stamp duty land tax, when changes to the tax regime were announced in advance, it always resulted in distortions to the market. And I think the real interesting thing is whether the higher end of this market begins to recover going forward. But as Philip says, there is anecdotal evidence at the moment of folk actually not moving and upgrading their properties in whatever manner they consider appropriate.
Okay, so I mean, you've gone on to say we believe it will be some time yet before the full impact of LBTT in the residential property market is understood. But the first quarter following introduction appears to have been a positive one for the residential property market in terms of mortgage lending. So what you're basically saying, if I get this right, is that in terms of the lower end of the market, I would suggest £325,000 or less LBTT, the changes have been positive, but your concerns are at the level above that. Okay. Now, Chris, you more or less agree with that. In the kind of last bullet point in the first page of your own excellent report, you've basically said that what you're suggesting is that the Scottish Government should increase the 5% rate threshold to £500,000 and abolish a 12% rate, which we believe is making a little positive contribution to LBTT revenues. And you go on to say that the distortion has been replaced by a new distortion at the point where a 10% rate begins.
Yes, thank you again for having me along today. I mean, we've got some direct evidence and that's been carried out very recently. You know, on the taking your point about the 12% rate, I think the point there is it's not generating tax take, so therefore, you know, what is the point in having it? Our numbers show that over 400,000 above, there's been a 22.5% decline in sales. And that's quarter on quarter, 2014, May to September, sorry, not quarter, May to September 2014 compared to May to September 2015. So that's a like-for-like comparable. And in terms of the £1 million plus, it's actually been 54% reduction in sales in that part of the market. Now, this is not about, as Philip says, feeling sorry for people at that part of the market. It's about stopping the market from functioning properly, which is the key point. People need to be able to move up. People need to be able to move down. And if there's a whole segment of the market that's static, you know, and in terms of the percentage that's relied upon above, you know, 325,000 for LBTT, it's something like 74% of your tax take is above that level. So, you know, if there's a 22 to 25% reduction in performance in that part of the market, then that's going to have a fairly profound effect. So I suppose what we're trying to advocate is a more progressive system, which introduces, you know, an interim band or and raises the 5% threshold up. So overall, you know, ultimately you should get the best of both worlds. You should get an increased tax take and the market should perform, you know, better.
Okay, thank you for that. I mean, I'm going to stick with you just for a minute, Chris, because obviously you've got a real interest in the commercial end, and you say that the move to a progressive rate of taxation with less radical change in rates and thresholds is acted to make the change in tax structure less marked, and this appears to have contributed to a smoother conversion from SDLT to LBTT, supported by enhanced revenue for the Scottish Government in line with strengthening the wider economy. Do you want to talk us through a wee bit more about how you feel the commercial sector has been affected?
I mean, I think because the 4 to 4.5%, you know, the commercial market is, you know, always prices in that tax level. So at the point of transaction, the way that it works in the commercial market is that is deducted from the value of the asset. So it affects the seller. So a 0.5% change is not, in terms of the commercial market, hasn't been material enough to see a wholesale change in activity. Now, I suppose what we have to guard against is, you know, the backdrop of the fragility of that market, and, you know, take Aberdeen, for example, which has been a huge part of the Scottish commercial property market activity. I mean, our work that's been carried out shows that value of transactions in Aberdeen, you know, for the previous quarter on quarter, fell from 201 million to 50 million. You know, so because of the downturn in that market, it can have fairly profound effects on tax take. So a reliance on the commercial market, I suppose, when it's still fragile, is maybe not the way to look at it. It needs to be a kind of, we still need to get the residential market performing at the same time.
Okay, thank you. And again, I want to stick with yourself, and then I'll ask Philip a similar question. It's about the role of Revenue Scotland, Chris. You said we had them in last week, actually, so it's perhaps unfortunate the timing of this, because we could perhaps put some of your questions to them at that point. But you've said there's a feeling that the guidance and administrative support side, Revenue Scotland, remains weak at this stage, and members feel restricted in being able to voice criticism because they need to have an ongoing relationship with Revenue Scotland in order to serve their clients' interest. This obviously gives you concerns in terms of reassessment. Again, I'd like your comments on that.
It's just around confidence in the market and the ability for commercial developers, investors, to be able to plan and to make sure that they understand the mechanisms behind how Revenue Scotland will work. So I think it's more just, we are keen to see further development of that, and we're keen to make sure that there's a bit more transparency generally.
Philip, you've said that you've got concern about the approachability of Revenue Scotland, and you said that it was noted that Revenue Scotland will not necessarily follow HMRC guidance.
I think just to keep this into perspective, though, we're talking about one or two comments here. So again, across a broad sample, it may be an isolation, but I can only relay them as they're reported back to us. I'm looking at actually the feedback that we had here and comments that there were indications early on that Revenue Scotland will be more approachable regarding inquiries. But we're hearing that from a number of colleagues that this has not been the case in practice. I think that the members were hopeful it might be easier to discuss complex LBTT cases on a sort of have a conversation. But it's reported to us that it's not been possible to speak with anyone on the phone informally, and it seems also difficult to obtain feedback by email. And it seems that the remedy is to seek a formal opinion from Revenue Scotland, and this process again is reported to us to have been quite slow. Now, this may be early days, teething problems or whatever, but I can only report as advised by us. But again, keeping that in perspective, that's just one member that has reported that specific issue, albeit they undertake quite a number of transactions with Revenue Scotland.
Okay, thank you for that. Kendra, you say there's no noise issues in terms of collection administration. But to go back just to to paragraph 6 of your report, you say that we believe the full impact of LBTT needs to be better understood, and then you go on to talk about long-term impact. So given what you've said in your report there, and what colleagues have said today, are you of the view that there should be changes to rates and bans for residential transactions for 2016-17 at this stage, or do you think we need to wait to see if further evidence comes in before any changes are made?
I think where I would come from on this is that if you look at the history, but as I said earlier, particularly of SDLT, when there have been tax changes announced well in advance, it does lead to a short-term distortion in the market. Now, the impact, as we're already, I think, all identified, is really at the higher end of the market. And it's whether that part of the market will recover to a more natural level over a period of time. I think if there's one lesson from this, is that basically I don't think you should announce changes in tax regimes well in advance, because people do actually take advantage one way or the other in terms of these changes in the tax regime. It doesn't distort the market. So I think we're only just 6 months into this new tax regime. I think you've got to at least see it for a full year. You're also in the residential market. I don't know so much about the commercial market. It's very cyclical in terms of you're beginning now to go into the quiet period in the housing market with Christmas, New Year, then also January, February, the weather doesn't help people looking for houses. Then it sort of begins to pick up in the spring, then it will die off a bit during the school holiday period, then pick up again after that. So it's very, very much a cyclical market as well, and we've not been through all the cycles as well.
Thank you very much, that's very helpful. We've now been joined by Jackie Bailey, so the committee is here at full strength. And I'm now going to open out questions to the committee. The first person to ask a question will be Jean, followed by Gavin.
Thank you, Convener. Really, just following on from one of your own questions, but when you talked, I think, Chris Stewart, about the 22% differential between the property sales at the higher end. And I seem to remember possibly something written in the same journal that you cited earlier, Mr. Hogg, about the fact that people did have advance notice of the 12% increase, and in fact that 22% differential is possibly asking you if that might be a bit artificial, and really we would need to compare perhaps the last 3 or 4 years to get a feeling for whether the increase, as I believe there was, the previous year in advance of the tax being imposed is in fact true.
I suppose that the issue is that, I mean, when you look at the market, there will be certainly short-term advancing of transactions, you know, when there's a tax change, but it won't roll through the entirety of the rest of the market. You know, people who are thinking of selling in September don't just advance and sell in March to hit the tax point. I mean, you know, you will see, which you did see in the figures, a short-term distortion. So in April and May, there were clearly less, but then, you know, the market returned to, you know, to the profile that you would consider to be normal. So, you know, the point is about a properly functioning market. All aspects of the market need to function for, you know, people to be able to downsize, you know, to once they've had their families, to be able to move into smaller properties, for families to be able to move in higher properties. And the threshold of where it's affecting the market is not just at the £1 million mark. It's right down to your tax point at 325,000. So, you know, it's hitting that main band of tax take. So it just, to me, seems very much out of kilter. And just as a sentiment point, one of the other things that has been picked out is that, take the £1 million sales, one of the things that I thought was quite telling, 2014, 27% of buyers were international. And that now in 2015 is 18%. You know, so clearly the tax structure, so that 12% is putting people off, irrespective of whether or not it's got a meaningful tax take. It's stopping people from investing in Scotland, which, you know, so the whole tax structuring goes to confidence about why to put your money into this country. So I think, you know, that to me is a critical point about how the market is perceived.
Just as a supplementary to that, surely we've referred to the oil industry, the downturn in the oil industry and other general economy of the nation, that you can't, I would suggest it wouldn't be right to place it all on the increase in tax. Would you agree with that?
No, I mean, we're advocating a balanced progressive system. We understand the need for a new, you know, LBTT system. There's no doubt about that. The old slab system didn't work. But, you know, other anecdotally, take the commercial market, for example. In Edinburgh, you know, the Atria building that is just being sold to Deka, the German fund, you know, that, I believe, had seven bids, none from a UK institution, all from international capital. Now, if that was in Manchester, there would have been 20 bids for the asset. So there's a regional distortion in our market, and it's about confidence. It's about understanding the way in which policy and tax will be structured. So, and certainly if there is a reliance in the market for international buyers, certainly in the commercial market, it's not the same in residential. Commercial markets have a dominance of international. They tend not to dive into the detail too much of how the market's operating. It's more sentiment. So that 12% rate, from a residential perspective, they'll pick up on, and they'll say, well, is this a progression towards, you know, a higher tax structure, and do we want to be in that market? So, you know, evidence from last week as well was about aligning policy with market sentiment, because I think that is critical.
Thank you.
Okay, Gavin to be followed by Mark.
We'll just start on that point then, Mr. Stewart. You gave the example of the atrium where you felt there would have been more bids had that property been in Manchester at this point in time. Obviously, the figures overall, the tax take overall for commercial property at the moment seems to be, if not ahead of schedule, slightly ahead of proposed schedule. But obviously, drilling down, what impact has having a marginally higher top rate of commercial property at 4% instead of 3.5%? What impact has that had, either anecdotally or evidence-based?
I think transactions that are going ahead haven't changed because of that 0.5% increase, as I said earlier. What happens is the seller gets the price adjusted, so it's a deduction from the price that happens. So I think the 4.5% commercially seems to be working, but please bear in mind that we should be looking at a profile of an increasing market. So the market should be making progress no matter what the tax banding is. So, you know, we've gone from an all-time low and our market is starting to recover. So if we are just, you know, meeting our expectations on tax take for LBTT relative to last year, well, maybe I would suggest that's not good enough. Maybe the commercial market, you know, with increased transaction activity and a more confident market, should be delivering more tax take on the same banding, if that makes sense. So we would like to see more transactional activity happening and more confidence in the market, which leads to more tax take. And the fact that it's only just slightly ahead or the same as it was previously, I would suggest that doesn't show enough confidence. And that's certainly borne out by the lack of depth in the commercial market for acquisitions, which is pretty significant. And, you know, the bigger point is that Edinburgh and Glasgow will do okay, you know, but that international capital doesn't roll into Kilmarnock, Kirkcaldy, Dunfermline. It's commercial transactions in those areas, you know, need to be pushed on. So it'd be interesting, and I don't have the figures, to understand what the impact is in secondary markets in Scotland, not the prime ones where Atria is being sold.
Okay, and the official SPF position is that you would call for parity with the rest of the UK at the top rate?
I mean, I think our view is that system isn't creating the same issues as our current system, so it would be sensible, I think, to meet that.
Okay. Question for Mr. Stewart and Mr. Hogg, because Mr. Foster has sort of answered this question already. In terms of your what you'd call for the changes to the residential bans and rates, you've outlined that you think the 5% ban threshold should be increased so that the 10% hits at a later time. It's no secret that I was sympathetic to that over the course of the last budget, but if the government were minded to look at that seriously, do either of you have a view on, let's say a change was going to be made either in your favour, at least in the direction of your favour, do you have a view on when such an announcement should be made? Should it be made on the 16th of December when we get the Scottish draft budget, or is it something which Mr. Foster pointed out that should happen right at the end of the budget process, you know, shortly before it takes effect? In terms of the overall health of the market, do you have views on when that ought to be announced, if it were to happen?
Do you want to? Okay. I mean, I suppose that one of the key points about the health of the market is, you know, house building, for example, relies on being able to forward project its activity, you know, being able to start its development, bring in labour, start ordering, you know, contract with subcontractors, all of that sort of stuff. So if it sees segments of the market where it's not going to be able to build, or it has a certain, you know, so we're not going to get take up at the 325, 400,000 above, it will pull back on its, you know, on its programme. So I think one of the key things, and maybe Philip can talk more about house building, is that certainty of environment and, you know, and the kind of behavioural patterns that have changed as a result of the LBTT. The sooner that those are communicated, if there was an inkling to do that, you know, I would have thought the market would respond with more activity, you know, and it's not just about it's about everybody from secondhand sales to production of new homes, and the production of new homes part is critical for not just the property market but for the wider economy. So, you know, the earlier that is communicated, the better.
The question, I believe, was if there were to be a change, when should that be announced? I think Kennedy made a very good point that on things like LBTT, stamp duty, the further in advance the market is aware, it will affect buyer behaviour, positively and negatively. So there is an argument that to minimise, if you like, those artificial transactions, then the lease notice possible is probably best. In our submission, we have we actually say that we think it's too early to take a definitive view, but we remain concerned, and there's nothing in, albeit still relatively early days, that has demonstrated to us that there isn't still a concern on that, on the way that the tax structure is configured. We do welcome the removal of that ban. We do welcome that progressive system. We think that's to be applauded, and we think that's great. And we do welcome the lower tax burden on the purchasers at the lower end of the market. I think all of those have been excellent, and Scottish Government should be applauded for that. However, our concerns remain, as announced originally, that we think it is too steep at that higher end. And the example I gave earlier on of the amount of additional transactions needed to offset just one lost sale, I think is where the risk lies. And I think that we have to understand that transactions in the residential market fall broadly into two categories. There are discretionary purchases. We don't need to move, but it would be nice to move. And then you have those that are essential moves. That may be due to family circumstances or change of job, etc. What we need is a tax system that encourages discretionary purchase. It encourages and rewards people that want to move up the housing ladder. Because that creates movement in the system, and it generates tax revenue, and it generates GDP by activity in the system. And we know for every home built, it creates over four jobs. So we want a tax system that encourages people to want to aspire to move and move up the housing ladder. Our fear here is that the tax system actually doesn't do that. In fact, it does the opposite. It makes people stop and think twice and actually say, do you know what, we'll stay where we are and we'll go and get the bathroom upgraded. Now, that's great for the bathrooms industry and maybe for the, you know, the smaller builders and all the rest of it, but I would suggest it doesn't create the impact, doesn't generate the tax, and it probably doesn't generate the GDP and the value to the Scottish economy. So again, we remain concerned. We're not calling for an immediate change, but we think that that this should be kept under a close review, with a view to adjusting it or to tweaking it. Maybe at some point in the future, if the trends continue as the evidence suggests at the moment.
Okay. Next question, I guess, is around that. I mean, obviously, in the run-up to April, we did see an increased volume of high-value sales. Part of April, we saw a reduced number of high-value sales, I guess, which was anticipated. Now, it might be too early to say, but sort of six, seven months on, what is your sense about the likely volume of high-value sales going forward? Was this a kind of temporary response to the changes, or is your evidence, whether it's anecdotal or otherwise, is your view now based on that actually we're just, unless there are changes, we're likely to see a reduced number of high-value sales as an almost permanent feature on the housing market?
I would say that based on the evidence that we have, that we would see a continued lower volume of activity in those middle upper ends of the market. Based on the information that we have and based on the feedback we get from our members, evidence of maybe changing the product mixes on their developments, to recognise that the impact that LBTT is having, and as in addition to other market forces as well, I should add that into the mix. But the evidence that we have is that there will be continued, well, for the foreseeable future, continued lower levels of activity at those levels in the marketplace.
Just what I wonder if other panellists are hearing similar or different things.
Yeah, not very much. I mean, we again think the trend is not a blip or an adjustment. It's more of a behavioural change because of the cost to move, and it's widely reported about the amount of activity in, upgrading your home to make it fit for purpose rather than moving, and it's the consequence that has on the broader market which is the issue. So again, it's not just about higher end homes, it's about how the whole market functions as a whole, and that's critical.
Okay, thank you. Question for Mr. Foster. In your paper pointed about the current position with mortgage applications and mortgages being granted, which in your paper seemed to be quite buoyant, I guess, in terms of overall numbers, but you then explained that doesn't necessarily correspond with tax take. But nonetheless, the mortgage market appeared to be doing fairly well. Do you have any sense of how that compares to the mortgage market as a whole across the UK? Are we broadly in line with them, has LBTT made at least a part of the mortgage market slightly healthier, or are those increases broadly in line with the UK?
I don't have the UK figures in front of me, sure. But I'm sure that first-time buyer figures in Scotland are higher than elsewhere in the UK. But broadly, the mortgage market in the current year has followed roughly the same pattern. The first 3 months of the year were pretty depressed, then it picked up for the second quarter, and our lending figures at UK level for the month of October, which were announced last week, show the highest level of mortgage lending since September 2008. So there is definitely an uptick in the mortgage market at the present time. But that can be caused, as I said earlier, by a range of factors. It's not just simply LBTT or SDLT.
Sure. Just for clarity then, I appreciate you don't have the exact figures in front of you. Your sense is that the mortgage market as a whole has performed similar to the UK, but in terms of first-time buyers, your sense is that it's higher in Scotland?
Yes,
okay, yeah. Thank you. And just one other question. This is to any of the three of you. We were aware of forestalling, where people delayed brought transactions forward to avoid higher taxes. To what extent did we see the opposite of that, where for houses of lower value financially, there was in some cases a tax benefit in holding off because the threshold went up to 145 instead of 125. So for some buyers, actually, there was an incentive to hold off. Did we see in some parts of the market people actually holding off, and then suddenly after April an increase in transactions at certain levels of the market?
We don't have any evidence that there was any significant delaying, if you like, to benefit from the new tax levels at those lower levels. I've got some statistics here, but I don't think that they're particularly revealing. Again, they reported it in my paper that 16.9% of transactions in Q1 2015 were below the 145 compared to 28 in 2014. So that that doesn't really give a massive picture. I think the feedback that we've had is the tax levels at those entry at the tax amounts at those entry level prices weren't game changers in themselves to persuade people to move one way or another. There was just actually one point that I almost would like to ask Kennedy. I know it's not my role to ask questions, but I think it might it may be I'd just be interested to know, Kennedy, whether you have any evidence or any data in terms of for property purchases in the higher price bands, how many of those are mortgage properties compared to cash purchases? Because I think that could be quite significant. We do hear that, you know, there are a considerable number of transactions where mortgages aren't required. So just using the mortgage figures may potentially not paint the full picture. Sorry, Kennedy, to throw that one at you.
No, I actually don't have that particular data in relation to what higher-end purchases or cash purchases. The figure which I have heard is really in terms of the buy-to-let market, which is obviously really the private rented sector. At least 20% of transactions in that sector are cash purchases, as opposed to folk needing to borrow to fund the purchase. So there is quite a higher level of cash purchases. And also, and not so much here in Scotland, but if you were to go to the likes of London, a lot of the investment in the property market in London is through cash purchases coming from overseas investors from China and the likes of the Middle East and Russia.
Lastly, to follow up, Philip, just to make sure I'm actually clear on this. Again, in terms of, you're saying there's not exact evidence, a lot of it's anecdotal, but your members were saying to you quite specifically, we have sped up some transactions to make sure we get them done before the April deadline. But those same members weren't saying to you, some people are delaying until after April. Is that fair?
There were one or two, but we're not talking big numbers here. And again, you know, a number of those, it would be with build programmes, it's sometimes difficult to vary that. But there wasn't any evidence that there was a large swell or large volume of transactions that were delayed until after the new tax system.
One of the anecdotal pieces of evidence on the market is that, you know, in a low transaction activity market, which is what we have at the higher end, you would expect, you know, an oversupply of stock on the market. You know, the market dynamics of oversupplying, people not taking up. Well, actually, the market is quite unique at the moment in that there is an undersupply of stock and an undersupply of, you know, buyers, and that goes to this behavioural activity of not wanting to put your house on the market because the cost to move is so. You know, I think that market dynamic is really quite telling, and also the duration of time that properties at the higher end of the market are sitting on the market is markedly longer, you know, substantially longer in some instances in areas where you would expect, you know, Edinburgh, you know, Glasgow prime areas of movement very quickly. They are taking over a year and a half in sometimes to sell, you know, whereas previously with that alter, you know, previously on the SDLT position, the market would have performed, but you know the lower level of the markets are actively working reasonably well. So it shows a dysfunctioning market.
Okay, thank you. And Mark to follow by Jackie.
Thank you, convener. Just looking through sort of all the evidence the committee has received, and what we've heard today, there have been various pieces of evidence which suggest market depression at sort of all levels. For example, National Association of Estate Agents have said that they feel there's a lack of stimulus at the lower end of the market, where there have been fewer transactions since the introduction of LBTT compared to comparable periods in the previous years. We've heard evidence today about higher end market depression, and we've heard about the sort of 325k plus as well. And yet, on the other hand, we're hearing evidence from Council of Mortgage Lenders about increases in terms of mortgage lending and mortgages. So I'm just wondering how, from the untrained eye perspective, how those two pieces of evidence tally and what the explanation that lies behind them would be. So I don't know if maybe you want to start, Mr. Stewart.
I don't know whether the evidence on mortgage numbers segments what are refinances, remortgages. You know, and you know, if as Philip has said, you know, the amount of cash activity in the top end of the market, you know, so unless it relates, like for like, then, as Philip maybe suggested, it's not easy to make a direct comparable and say mortgage lending up, therefore market overall is good. I don't think that's the right way to look at it. You know, and we should be looking at a market that's moving out of its, you know, lowest position in reality since 2008, 2009, and moving forward. You know, we shouldn't be looking at a kind of stalling market. So I just don't think the evidence necessarily aligns.
Mr. Fox, I think I heard you saying that your figures did disaggregate between what was mortgage lending, yeah, and what was remortgaging and refinancing.
Yeah, our press releases all split it between loans for house purchase, then the split out from loans for house purchase, first-time buyer purchases, and there's a separate section around remortgages, and the remortgage market's pretty flat at the moment.
So the increases that you've been speaking about are around first-time buyers and mortgage
house purchase, yeah.
And house purchase, yeah. Okay. And within that data, does it disaggregate around values within that data, or is it purely there has been an increase in terms of mortgage lending, but it doesn't disaggregate across value of mortgage?
Correct.
Okay. Another thing which I wonder if you might care to comment on is I noticed certainly in a lot of the press reporting at the time leading up to the introduction of LBTT that there was a great deal of reporting that, for example, if you purchased a house over £750,000, you would pay 12% on the entire purchase, which of course was not how the banding works, but it was report. In fact, in one newspaper, I think I saw a correction to a previous report, and then on the following page, a reiteration of that very same reporting. And I wonder if you have any anecdotal or otherwise evidence around behavioural impact that was had as a result of some of that reporting that suggested, you know, quite significant hikes in terms of tax on property purchases, which was not actually the reflection of how LBTT was to be introduced. I don't know if Mr. Hogg, if you want to maybe go first on that.
Not aware of the specific reports that you refer to, so I can't really comment on all of that. I think that, as with any new tax system, there's a period of time for it to be understood and for it to be communicated correctly. The only thing that I would say, and I would encourage members to maybe go online or pick up property supplements maybe after this meeting, but a quick scan of the property adverts, particularly new build, and you'll find, I'm taking a gamble here, but hopefully I'll prove incorrect, you'll probably find a fair number of incentives along the lines of LBTT paid. That seems to be the incentive that most new home purchasers are looking for just at the moment. And I think that is symptomatic in itself. That is a reflection of that appears to be the stumbling block for many people. So again, that's the market responding to what is thrown back at them as the barriers to purchase. But in terms of your specific comment, we're not aware of misunderstanding of the LBTT amounts. So no, I can't comment on that particular point.
Mr. Stewart, do you have anything to add?
I mean, I would suggest that at the, you know, the higher level of transaction, you know, these people are very well advised, whether it's agents or lawyers or whatever. So, you know, any press reporting of a level would be very quickly qualified. But I don't see that there's any, again, evidence of people fundamentally misunderstanding the position.
Mr. Foster, I mean, obviously the mortgage lenders would have perhaps been approached by people asking about LBTT and its impact. Is there any evidence that you've picked up in that relation when it was first?
None whatsoever.
Okay, that's fine. I note that of the three of you, Scottish Property Federation have gone out on a limb in terms of making a suggestion for changes that would be made. I wonder, Mr. Stewart, looking at the changes that you've suggested, whether you've done any modelling or any hypothecation about the likely impact that would have in terms of revenues if those changes were to take effect, both in also in terms of market activity, but also in terms of the likely revenues that could or would be collected if those changes were made?
We certainly have done some modelling. Getting the specific numbers for you, I don't have them immediately to hand, but we'd be happy to.
I think that would be quite helpful.
We'd
for the
happy
committee
to
see
that.
To see what the impact would be. I guess the question that follows on from that, and perhaps this is one, because I know Mr. Foster and Mr. Hogg have kind of hedged their bets in terms of suggesting changes because they feel perhaps more information or more data would be required, is given we've spoken about, for example, in the northeast of Scotland, which myself and Mr. Baker are very familiar with, obviously, as representatives from that corner of Scotland, there have been other external factors around the price downturn, employment issues. How confident or otherwise can we be that simply readjusting LBTT rates in and of itself will lead to that market stimulation compared to perhaps other factors that may affect? Because obviously if changes were to be made on the basis that it was assumed it would kickstart purchases, and that then didn't happen, that then obviously has a further effect in terms of collected revenue, particularly if the threshold has been reduced at part of the market. But be grateful for your thoughts around that.
I mean, I think it, you know, they take the 12% down, for example, that the level of activity in that market, I mean, there's been a, as we've said, a huge drop in volume. But there's so little activity in that market from a number of units perspective, you know, it goes towards sentiment, you know, putting that band in place. The reliance, you know, 74% of tax take above £325,000. So, you know, 7% of your market, you know, you're relying on 74% of your tax take. There is going to be a benefit if there is a adjustment downwards of any of those rates positively, you know, because you probably can't get any less out of that top end than you're already getting, you know. So, you know, a realignment would make a difference, I'm sure.
Okay. I don't know if Mr. Hogg or Mr. Foster, you want to comment on the sort of the broader issue, perhaps, rather than the specific proposal.
Just to close the loop on, I mentioned looking at the press, so that, you know, there's a real example of, you know, of how home builders are trying to overcome where the objections to purchasing are. So I'm sure there's plenty more of those. Returning to your question, I recall that the Finance Secretary, his objectives were for the new system to be revenue neutral. From the information that I've seen, and I'll stand to be corrected on this, I think the forecasts are that it's looking as if that may not be achieved. So if the tax take isn't, if the system isn't delivering the tax take, then that surely suggests that it needs to be reviewed and investigated. So I think that's the basis that we have to say, well, why isn't it delivering the forecast revenue, and look at where the sensitive areas are. I mean, in terms of developing an alternative system, we propose that 5% band be widened, and I think that's still our view as to that's probably the area which needs investigation. But clearly our colleagues at Scottish Property have come up with alternative systems, and I'm sure that there'll be many other different ways that it could be done. So we haven't come to the table today saying here's a pre-prepared one, but I say all we're coming here today saying our concerns remained as originally reported.
Mr. Foster,
indeed. Yeah, I think the decision to invest in a house is a range of factors involved in taking that decision. And obviously, if you're going to borrow, one of the things is it affordable for you to take on the mortgage? What are the predictions in terms of the likes of interest rate rises going forward? So consumer confidence, employment prospects, house prices all play a decision in the decision to invest. I would echo what Chris said, and I think it's something probably the government do need to focus on, and I don't make this comment from a political perspective, I make it more from a risk perspective. When you're so much of your tax take is coming from such a small number of sales, it must be a risk to you if that part of the market actually declines by such an extent. As I say, I don't make it from a political context. I make it purely in terms of risk.
And just finally, Convener, there was some mention, I think it was Mr. Stewart who spoke about the impacts at RUK level of the changes there. Do you have any evidence around what the impact or otherwise has been of the changes that were made to stamp duty land tax south of the border?
I mean, I suppose I don't have the statistics for the residential market, but we certainly know from a commercial perspective that the transactional levels that we would expect in our regional markets, if you like, Edinburgh, Glasgow, are substantially, you know, the amount of investment into those markets is substantially reduced. And the way that we measure that is about the likes of the comment about how many, you know, bidders would go for a prime asset in Manchester relative to Edinburgh. Now, there should be no difference in their approach because they are both very strong regional cities. But at the moment, I mean, the way that commercial property is valued is on the basis of its income and a percentage, a yield is applied to that. Edinburgh trades at a discount to that of Manchester, which is historically should not be the case. And we have, you know, as I say, the difference between 20 interested buyers in a prime Manchester asset from 7 in an Edinburgh asset. So there's something not quite right that's not allowing those investors to be attracted into the Scottish market. And that's what creates its fragility. So changes in tax, you know, just add to that fragility or the sentiment around tax. So that's one of our overriding concerns, is about, you know, how potentially unstable the market is.
Sure. I think I'm sure you would agree that drawing a wider conclusion based on perhaps one example or two examples is difficult to do. And so if you have other data in the same respect in terms of the data asked about previously, it would be very nice to see some of that, which would perhaps allow for a slightly more reflective picture of what's happening.
Well, we'd be delighted. There's lots of information that we can pull together to support, because there are a number of different strands to that, not just LBTT, clearly.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Jackie, to be followed by John.
Thank you very much, Convener. Just pursuing that last point with Mr. Stewart, is there anything to suggest that fragility will remain?
Yes, there is. I mean, it's pretty well known that UK institutions and, you know, institutional investors who are the big funds that we all know, you know, are not making the same level of investment that they historically did. You know, and in a lot of instances, they have filled their books with investment. So their 7% allocation of their funds, for example, is not extending. That means there's an increased reliance on international activity, international capital, which, you know, SPF has analysed about 70% of the Scottish market. Now, you have to understand the profile of those investors, because that international capital, it's not a domestically based, a locally based institutional fund or bank. It's probably headquartered in New York or the Middle East. Money comes into Scotland, and it really focuses around the prime asset that it's investing in. So if you think about, you know, Bank of Scotland of old and RBS, they were locally based here, so they were in the market. They had an interest in funding the market. So that capital now looks at investing in Edinburgh alongside multiple European cities, so Barcelona, Madrid, London. And it tends to come here as a result of not being able to invest in London because the market's too hot. So again, the reliance on that type of market is very fragile. What we're trying to encourage is a kind of more consistent market where there's an encouragement of that capital to stay, if what has happened with both our banking system, because of slotting and the changes in capital requirements, it means that our banks can't invest more to support local businesses. There's a ceiling to what they can deliver. So all these factors mean an increase in dependency on a more fickle international investor. So that would be our concern. So that fragility is evident.
We'll be in a position to model that behaviour and estimate the likely risk if that information is out there already.
Well, I think the behavioural assumptions become more, you know, macroeconomic, global conditions. So, you know, if an investor in New York gets a better return in Spain for the same allocation of capital, and why would he put it into Scotland? So all of a sudden it's about your competing structure, you know, and how you look as an economy and how attractive you are for that capital. If we had more local capital, we wouldn't be having the same conversation. So to model it, you need to look at the global markets, you know.
Okay, that's helpful. I just wanted to follow up that point. Others have explored, you know, lower transactions at the high end of the market, and I think Mr. Hogg should definitely be on commission with that bathroom company. I think I counted three times now. Let's see if you can manage a fourth. But I want to look at the level of receipts for residential transactions in particular. And I want to understand the world you guys understand, which is seasonality. Okay. What we're told by another submission is that typically by the time you get to the end of October, you should have expected 62% of the receipts to be in, with 38% still to come. Is that your feel? I mean, can you describe to us, you know, what's likely to happen between November and March? And let me start with Mr. Hogg.
I won't mention the bathroom company. I can assure you I have no affiliation in any professional or personal with that bathroom company. Seasonality. I think Kennedy maybe described it fairly early on. I can articulate it in a way that maybe behaviour many of us would understand. Immediately after the new year, we find that typically consumers tend to have that period of post-festive depression. So we start to see bookings of holidays and purchases of new homes typically, or the searching for the process of buying a new home starts to pick up, and I've modelled this by internet traffic. We start to see round about the 12th, 13th, 14th of January, we start to see massive hikes in internet searches for property. That's the start of the cycle. So that's when people start looking, start visiting showrooms, start looking online. The purchase process in terms of from the day that you first look to the day that you maybe get the keys to the door, you know, it depends on how well advanced the construction program is. I'm talking of a new build, not obviously existing property. But if we talk around about 3 months, maybe a little bit longer. So we will find a peak in transactions, i.e. sales completed, round about the Easter period. So we see a rapid rise in activity, Easter and early summer. It dips off again during the summer months for the reasons I think Kennedy described, the school holidays. And then we see a second peak of activity immediately after the school holidays, sort of the September-October period, before the period we call tinselitis, which is which seems to get earlier and earlier, just when the tinsel appears in the shops, and then buying a new home is, because people again have targets. If I'm going to buy in that autumn period, I want to get in before Christmas. And logistically, that for some people, that's just too squeezed. So we see a second peak of activity, a lower level of activity in the autumn winter period. So we see a curve that looks like that. That's the shape. And we've modelled that with our transactions years gone by, and it doesn't change. The only things that change are if there are any stimulants in the marketplace, such as help to buy or changes in the tax regime, might accentuate some of those patterns. But the overall pattern is fairly predictable and fairly consistent of a pattern that looks like that.
Given that doesn't work very well for
No, that
it works for me. The visual works for me, but I love tinselitis. That's a new word I've learnt today. So typically, you've had your two peaks already contained within these figures. Is that right, Kennedy?
I was just going to add, I used to, in a previous life, run a mortgage processing operation for a major lender, and one of our busiest periods used to be in the lead-up to Christmas. And I think that is people who are out in September, October, looking to buy houses, they're actually completing. They want in their house before Christmas. And I think what you've got to bear in mind is the LBTT is actually paid at completion. So I wouldn't necessarily have seen it. I think you could still have strong receipts through to just before Christmas, but it will die off as we go into the new year if it follows the pattern of mortgage borrowing.
So basically you'd expect January, February, March to be
quiet.
Very, very quiet.
Quiet,
but yeah. Actually there's still activity right the way up to Christmas. Okay, that's helpful.
If I could just add another small point on that, which may have a distortion effect this specific year. The Scottish Government Help to Buy scheme all of those properties that are eligible under Help to Buy have to complete by Christmas. So again, that will create, if you like, a higher peak than probably normal, because those transactions have to be completed to ensure that the funding's delivered.
Okay, that's helpful for me to understand. Now, Scottish Property Federation commented very specifically on this area, and I don't think the others did in their submissions. So, Chris, your paper forecast, or you compared it, and there's a 5% shortfall against 2013-14, a 25% shortfall against 2014-15. Could you maybe just explain that to us a bit, and what your thinking is on however difficult this might be to estimate, but the estimated year-end figures?
Now, so you're 60% of 246 million, which was the kind of projected take across the bands in residential. So that should be your benchmark for this time in the year. You're 60%, if you know it follows the normal pattern. And what we know, I think, is, and I might stand to be corrected on these, but broadly 118 million has been delivered in that same period. So at this stage in the market, there seems to be about a 30 million shortfall for this period. And depending on, I would suggest that's not going to be caught up. Whether the gap widens or maintains the same, you know, that's a 23% shortfall May to October. From what was predicted. So whether it maintains 23% over the period or it broadens, I don't know. But I think that's enough to highlight the difference.
Okay, so you've made no forward projections taking account of some of the incentives that might distort the market?
I think we would see that continuing. So, you know, that wouldn't...
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, tiny.
Just a very short supplementary on that, if I could. You say there's about £30 million shortfall on where we would expect to be. I note from the submission that we have from the Fiscal Commission that Scottish Government estimate between 12 to £37 million of forestalling. So of that £30 million shortfall, how much of that do you think could potentially be attributed to the forestalling effect? Or is that something you would have any information on?
I think the point really is that you need to try and separate out the commercial market with the residential market because they're performing very differently. I know that you can combine them to make the figures, but if you're looking at the residential sector, then it's certainly not going to be of the quantum of, you know, potentially 50, 60 million by the end of the year. So, you know, there may be an element which would have been collected in the year previously, but it certainly, as I say, behavioural patterns won't be that people moving in September advanced it to April, you know, and we saw that correction, you know, less transactional activity in May. So I can't say specifically, but I wouldn't think it was a huge amount.
Okay, thank you. Deputy Convener.
Thanks, Convener. Following on that point, I mean, we've been given three possible scenarios, as I understand it, and we've still to see the Scottish Fiscal Commission next. But out of the three forecasts, I mean, two are showing that the actual position is behind forecast, one is showing it's ahead of forecast. So I'm not sure how certain you are that we're behind forecast.
Well, again, just on the residential market, you know, the every month on month, every month, there is a substantially less take than so in April. I mean, my numbers here are a bit kind of, I think the difference between previous year was, you know, 18.3 million. And say in April that was down substantially to, but that would be as a result of the transition to the new tax. May revenue this year 11.4, last year 19.8, June 18.5, last year 24.2.
You're comparing to last year rather than the forecast, because the forecast was 235. Then the forestalling can be 12, 20, or 37.
Yeah. Our forecast, again, going back to my original position, if you take 60% of the market activity or 60% collection for this time of year, and you know,
three, but that's roughly
so 63%, even then, you would expect higher, so you'd expect over 150 million of take. And as far as we can see, there's 118 million for
depending how much the forestalling is. Have you taken into account forestalling then?
Well, answering, I suppose, the previous question, there will be an element of that, but not to the extent there's a 30.
Well, one of the figures we've been given is 235 is the forecast, 37 is the forestalling. That takes us to 153. So that's actually ahead of what's actually happening.
So how would you explain 37 million of forestalling?
Well, that we're still to discuss that. As I say, we haven't had the Fiscal Commission in yet, but the Scottish Government forecast for forestalling were between 12 and 37. The OBR was 20. So, I mean, I don't think we've clarified yet how much the forestalling was.
So, but 37 million.
Onto 116 is 153. I mean, I don't want to get too bogged down in figures. My point, I suppose, would be there's a variety of figures out here.
But 37 million of take on forestalling would mean that, you know, if it was commercial property on a higher tax basis, that 822 million. Pounds worth of transactional activity was...
Sorry, I'm just talking about residential here.
Well, that's even worse. You know, that in terms of the figure, I mean, that's a huge number that would have forestalled.
Well, we'll still discuss that further with the other witnesses, but anyway, my main point would be that there are some of the forecasts showing we're behind... where actual is behind forecast, some are... one, at least one is showing that we're ahead of forecast. Okay. I mean, you're all feeling that LBTT has had a big impact or sizable impact on sales and prices and so on. Has anyone done an objective study on this? For example, one of the universities or any kind of research body? Or is it really just kind of subjective feelings?
No, I mean, it's definitely not subjective feelings. I mean, our businesses cover, you know, whole sections of the market. You know, we're not just covering individual segments. I mean, Homes for Scotland clearly cover the entirety of the market. So this isn't sentiment. It's actual delays in property sales. It's actual...
Prospective sellers or purchases or prospective purchases.
That's Savills reports. That is evidence. It's not.
And who's that based on? How have they found that out?
So it's a combination of their own transactional research, myhouseprice.com. So it's evidence based. It's not. It has.
Have they actually asked purchasers or sellers?
Yes.
They have.
But because they're agents, they're property agents, they deal with transactions on a...
Well, I know they deal with transactions, and they could therefore say how much has it gone up, how much has it gone down. I think my question is, why has it gone up, why has it gone down, and how have they found that out?
Well, I suppose we're all in the market. We all deal with buyers, sellers, whether it's commercial real estate, residential real estate. I mean, it's not just discussion, it's fact. And you know, there are...
Well, I'm sorry, but I really question how it's fact. I mean, it seems to me we're 6 months into a new system. You know, unless some kind of academic organisation has studied it properly...
The year-on-year difference in over 400,000 for May to September, 1,283 sales in this year, 1,657 sales last year for the same period.
So the fact is it's down. But my question is, if, say, we take Aberdeen, where the oil price is way down, there's a whole lot of factors going on, has anyone really studied how much of the sales drop is through the oil price, how much of the sales drop is through LBTT? Or is it just that you're coming to the committee, you'd like to see the taxes down, and so you're arguing that it's all based on LBTT?
No, we would love to be able to say that it's worked. I mean, because what we're looking for is a positive, buoyant market. It's not a political point. This is about a successful market where jobs are being created, where people are being able to move houses at whatever level.
On the jobs being created, are jobs being created because people move or just because there's new houses built?
Well, there's both. I mean, there's employment in both sectors, clearly.
Yeah. I mean, my next area that I'm really not sure about is how quickly all of this is going to settle down, and that's been touched on by other members. The first question would be, are we in a settled position now? Or are some of the people at the more expensive end waiting to see if in April the rates might come down following all of your arguments? And so we're actually still in a forestalling period. Can we tell that?
My guess can only be as good as anyone else's around this table. I'm not aware that there's been an awful lot of press comment about or speculation that there's going to be an adjustment in rates. Certainly that's not the message that our members understand and the messages that we would be putting out to the marketplace. So I wouldn't have thought that there were many people sitting, waiting, hoping that maybe the rates may be adjusting. That's a personal opinion as opposed to one that I've researched. Your first part of the question was, has the forestalling elements, is that washed through now? Will we be into a normal market? I think that the real test will be Q1 next year, although taking to Kennedy's very valid point that the tax revenues follow a little bit after the purchase activity. I would have thought that by Q1, certainly by Q2 next year, we'll know what the pattern is looking like and whether there is a continued depression of activity at those upper levels. If it still looks as if it's reduced, then I would suggest that would be the norm, the new norm, and whatever implications that has for tax. I think that we're getting through now the adjustment period. And picking up on the point I think you were making to Chris, I would have thought that some of the key estate agents, such as Savills, Knight Franks and others, would be very well placed to give you a very accurate picture of consumer behaviour at the sharp end. They will be speaking with prospective purchasers and sellers on a day-in, day-out basis and know how they're actually behaving, how they're reacting. I can only report back from our members who are telling me the conversations they have with prospective purchasers in sales centres where LBTT is a big issue for those people that are particularly affected by it in those in the price brackets we've been speaking about.
Okay, so from what you're saying, we're talking about quarter one, quarter two next year before we really see if things are settling down. So it would be best actually then if we left all the rates the same at the moment, because if we change any of the rates, that's just going to confuse things more, isn't it?
I think that's correct. Hence the reason in our paper we've suggested that that we keep it under review for a little bit longer. But if the evidence by the end of Q2 next year is this pattern is emerging, then we think that the concerns would then be valid and it would need a serious review.
Mr. Stewart, you said, I think at one stage earlier, that certainty was a good thing. So again, would you agree that it would be best to leave things in this year's budget and review it again next year?
I mean, I certainly think getting a full year of data is important. you know, to just mop all of that up. And, you know, we would welcome any review post that full year to see what the effect has been.
Okay, thanks so much. I mean, you also mentioned in your input that this was all having an effect on the labour skills area, that, I don't know, was the suggestion that we were losing out on some skills because people couldn't afford to buy houses?
I suppose it's more around, you know, the development of the house building and construction industry generally. You know, in order to invest in new developments, new land banks, and also the skills that are required to increase that activity, then, you know, consistency and understanding of where the market is. And so if sections of the market aren't performing, then house builders aren't going to be building homes in that part of the market. That doesn't mean they're going to be building more homes in a lower end of the market. That's not the way it works. So the consequence is that they're not investing in the jobs, and we know that from, you know, speaking to the contractors that we work with to grow their businesses, which is fundamentally what we want to see in the market, is a healthy performing real estate market, which is supplied by a healthy performing construction market.
Explain to me why. I mean, if wealth was shared out more evenly across the country, then instead of a £1 million house, we would have somebody would build 10 £100,000 houses, which I would assume would create more jobs. So would it not be better, and does it not happen, that instead of building very expensive houses, we build more cheaper houses?
I don't think it's as simple as that, to be perfectly honest. I think the issue that we find in the construction industry and the house building market is, you know, most house building and construction businesses are suffering from the financial crisis of 2008. They have yet to recover. Banks aren't funding those SME businesses to the extent that they were, you know, so the local debt providers that we would usually turn to aren't in the market for those. So therefore, the activity is just not happening out with the kind of major house builders in the market. So the capacity in the market isn't there, whether it's in, you know, lower end homes, as you suggest. You know, so it's a confidence issue.
Okay, another one to yourself. I mean, going on to commercial properties, the comparison was made between Edinburgh and Manchester, and the feeling, I think, that Edinburgh was suffering because, again, because of LBTT. But, I mean, if you take London, I mean, London prices presumably are higher, and even if their SDLT was lower, the net effect is that it's more expensive to invest in London, and yet people do invest in London. So it's not quite as simple as saying people will go to the cheaper location, is it?
I don't think that's what I was saying.
Right. Can you explain what you were saying?
So the
why is Edinburgh disadvantaged against Manchester?
Well, the point is that there should be no disadvantage. There shouldn't be a disparity between transactional activity in those two markets. You know, Edinburgh has traditionally been second, really, to London as the kind of next place for commercial real estate investors to put their capital, and that's evidently not happening. So, you know, what I'm painting is a picture where, for some reason, an LBTT is a part of it. As I said earlier, it's not the entire reason, but that activity is not coming as it would otherwise do into the Scottish markets.
Again, has anyone studied that to see really what the reasons are? Has anyone spoken to the developer?
There's a lot of anecdotal activity and information. Whether somebody's researched it formally, I don't think that's been the case, but it's more down to number of transactions, and the extent of interest in the commercial property market is not the same as a Manchester. So, you know, I think more research, frankly, needs to be done in that area.
Okay, fair enough. And I think my final area, Mr. Hogg, I think it was yourself, talked especially about this guidance from HMRC, and in fact that Revenue Scotland was not following HMRC guidance. I mean, given that our law is slightly different, should Revenue Scotland be following HMRC guidance?
did I say, following HMRC guidance?
Was it not yourself that said that? Sorry.
I see it's noted on page 3 of our evidence. The point that we're making there on the bottom of page 3 of my document is that it was reported by one of our members that Revenue Scotland weren't following HMRC guidance, even when the rules or the provisions within LBTT and SDLT are identical. So that's where one of our members raised concern as to they couldn't see any logical reason why that guidance wouldn't be followed. We were invited to comment on the performance of Revenue Scotland, and I'm merely reporting back as reported to us.
Enough. I mean, I accept that. I suppose for me, one of the fundamental differences is the general anti-avoidance rules, and that they are slightly different in Scotland and under Revenue Scotland than HMRC. So even though, you know, a little bit the detail of the legislation might be the same, the overall picture's different. So I suppose I would question whether Revenue Scotland should always be issuing the same guidance, even in a similar situation to HMRC.
I think this may go back to the point that I raised before about the opportunity for people to have an informal discussion with Revenue Scotland to get that understanding about, look, this is, and that this apparently evidences itself in complex transactions where people are looking to get some guidance as to how this should be dealt with, how these particular cases should be handled by Revenue Scotland. And again, the evidence that came back to us is that maybe not as much access as was available previously to have these discussions about how these transactions should be presented or how they should be calculated. More of that opportunity to have those discussions, I think, is what the call has been from our members.
People who are trying to avoid tax?
I've absolutely no idea, but I would suspect probably not. These are lawyers that have presented this data to us. So I think any inference of trying to avoid tax, I think this would be misplaced.
Okay, thanks so much.
Okay, thank you very much for that. That has concluded questions from the committee. Are there any final points that have not been covered that you may wish to touch on? Witnesses? No? Okay, well, thank you very much for that, for answering our comprehensive questions. Thank you. I'm now going to call a 5-minute recess to enable a changeover of witnesses. continue scrutiny of the devolved taxes by taking evidence from the Scottish Fiscal Commission. I'd like to welcome to the meeting Lady Susan Rice, Professor Andrew Hughes Hallett, and Professor Campbell Leith. So welcome once again to the Finance Committee. Before we go to questions, I'd like to invite Lady Rice to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning. And I think it is still morning, yes. And thank you for the chance to provide some comment today. You asked us specifically to share some views in relation to LBTT receipts relative to the outturn figures to date, and also to comment to the extent we can on the impact of forestalling. You also asked for some commentary on the government's forecast on landfill tax, and we have given you a short paper in relation to both of those. A couple of reminders in relation to landfill tax, and I have put this in writing previously. We only have to date 1/4 worth of data. The second quarter, we believe, comes out the end of this week or next week, and because there is a seasonality factor in landfill data, that is very little material on which to base judgments. We've done what we can, but just a caution, which I'm sure you all do understand, this is an imperfect science at this stage. The other comment is in relation to LBTT, and I want to thank you for taking the most up-to-date version of our paper yesterday. We prepared the paper using the 6 months of data through the end of September, at the point we needed to submit the paper to the committee, and as the 7th month October data had very recently come out, we thought it was important to add that in, and that was the main change, plus a couple of clarifications in the paper that we sent out. That was important for reasons which we can go into more fully. Again, just a comment on that tax as well. There are factors with LBTT of both seasonality and forestalling, and every month more worth of data that we have, the clearer some of these factors will become. So again, looking midway is an imperfect science, and I believe you do understand that, but I think it's really important to note that for the record. So those are my comments, and we're very happy to take questions. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that brief opening statement, and as you'll know, I usually ask the opening questions, and then I'll open out to colleagues around the table. I mean, I notice you know you've said on your letter of 19th of November that there's a challenge in making a judgment about a year's forecast based on part year data, where assumptions have to be made about the effects of seasonality and of forestalling on the observed outturn date, and I think the committee is fully appreciative of that. But in terms of the letter of the 19th of November and the recent paper, there's been quite a significant change in terms of the outturn data analysed. For example, the minimum figure in the first paper of 215.5 million has dropped quite considerably to 203.9 million, and the maximum has fallen from £247.4 million to £243.5 million. I understand you're saying that's because of an extra month's data. Have these figures been shared with the Scottish Government?
The most recent report, which was sent out to the clerk at the very end of the afternoon yesterday, sent it to the Fiscal Commission office and asked that that be shared with the Deputy First Minister this morning, first thing. So this is really late-breaking data. It hasn't been shared beyond yourselves and his office this morning.
Okay, well, thank you very much. I do appreciate that. And you've talked about typically 63% of revenues, 62.98, would be expected to have been raised over this part of the year. And that gives you the kind of figures that have already been quoted. But that gives you quite a massive difference. I mean, we're talking about a kind of error of, you know, somewhere potentially of some almost £40 million, actually. I mean, in fact, the figures here, it says 31.18 and minus 8.9, which is £40 million, although the figures in the graph annualised seem to be £39.6 million. But either way, there seems to be quite a huge difference in terms. I mean, I'm just wondering, you know, in terms of the figures that we're actually talking about, you're talking about a potential marginal difference of some 16%. Would that be right?
Campbell, do you want to?
Sorry, which figures would you?
Well, sorry, if you're looking at what you've actually said in your most up-to-date paper is in the very last sentences, you've talked about the implied estimated forecast error is going to be between 31.1 million and minus 8.9 million pounds, which, if you're looking at an overall tax take of, you know, somewhere between 203.9 and 243.5 million of about 16 odd percent. I mean, that's quite a huge difference in potential forecast. I mean, despite seasonality, despite the issue of only having a few months' data. I mean, what kind of margins would you be expecting in terms of forecast error in a normal year for a normal tax? I mean, it just seemed quite. It's almost a guesstimate. Almost, it seems.
Okay, well, for this particular tax, the way the Scottish Government forecast it, what they're doing is they're essentially extrapolating current prices and current transactions to long-run averages. They're then applying a kind of distributional model of transactions throughout the distribution of house prices. And from that, they can build up estimates of the projected tax take. There's no actual formal statistical modelling goes into the projection of prices or transactions. It's therefore not possible to assign standard statistical bounds of error to that forecast. And so we cannot formally say the standard error for this is X percent, given the techniques employed. On top of that, for this particular year, because it's a change in tax regime, we have forestalling effects, which I think you've been discussing earlier this morning. And as a result, what we see from the data is that the outturn data is significantly below what you would expect given the seasonality you would normally expect in the data. Now, this may be because of a temporary forestalling effect, or it may be that the change in the tax regime has permanently subdued certain parts of the market, and this will continue indefinitely. Therefore, the extent to which there's an underlying forecast error depends crucially on how much you believe this shortfall in the early part of the year is a temporary phenomenon or is an ongoing phenomenon.
I mean, it seems though that the median in terms of the forecasting error is going to be err towards over-optimism, even though the Scottish Government's prediction was significantly lower than that of the OBR, which means that the OBR prediction was way out in terms of being over-optimistic, and obviously that had implications for the block grant adjustment. But when we look actually at landfill tax, basically, you seem to have looked at figures from the UK as a whole. I mean, one of the things when we were looking at the whole passage of the legislation in terms of landfill tax, one of the things critiques of the OBR was that they just gave figures for Scotland which extrapolated UK figures. But it seems from what we've got here is that you've done exactly the same here. You've talked about the UK as a whole in terms of Scottish Government revenues, and you've basically just said, we therefore scale the outturn data, assuming such seasonality also applied in Scotland, which gives quite a significant forecast error of between 39 and 53 million pounds.
Yeah, so the outturn data is Scottish-only data. We don't have the historic data for the revenues to be able to compute the seasonality for Scotland at this stage. It will take a few years of seasonality to be observed before we can do that for Scotland.
I mean, so what you're basically saying is you've tried to do on the kind of, considering the difficulties you've had with forestalling, seasonality, the fact it's a new tax, etc., you've had to basically do your best within kind of fairly broad parameters. But what you're effectively saying is that as the years progress, you expect to be able to hone this quite significantly and make much more accurate forecasting.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much for that. John?
Yes, well, I think really on the same theme. I mean, I was just really wondering myself how, and I asked the previous witnesses, as you might have heard, you know, how quickly can we get, you know, a clearer picture and what's been happening? And I mean, they seem to be suggesting, well, at least we've got 1 year's figures. But I mean, is it the case that 1 year's figures will give us a clearer picture, or do we need to actually wait longer than that?
Well,
you can perhaps start to see something already if you look at the second table in the updated document we provided. It kind of breaks down what you would expect to receive from residential LBTT by month compared with the liabilities that were actually generated. And so the second last column is the difference. So that's the how much we didn't receive that we were expecting to receive. And you can see that in April that was 10.6 million, so that's quite massive. And then it falls throughout those early months until August, where it practically disappears. So had that continued in August, had the kind of forecast error been zero for the next 2 months of data, you might have concluded that that early 4 months was the forestalling effect. But the fact that it then bounces back a bit in September, well, is the forestalling effect truly over, or is this still an ongoing permanent effect? So from this data, you know, the best guess is there's a combination of forestalling and perhaps a little bit of a longer-term effect. We simply don't know until it all plays out.
Well, I mean, that's certainly consistent with, I think, what the previous witnesses were saying, that, I mean, they didn't seem to feel that there was currently a forestalling effect in the hope that the rates might fall next year. But again, you know, I suppose who knows that? And I mean, we've got other factors like the oil price affecting prices in Aberdeen. So, I mean, presumably, I mean, part of this, it could be other factors that are having an effect and LBTT is not very much, or it could be that actually other factors are less and LBTT is more, I guess.
So it could be broad economic conditions, it could be forestalling, it could be a permanent effect from the change in regime as well. Any one of those three factors or combination of them will explain the data ultimately.
Make an equally awkward point, and you're never going to know because you can't separate these two out, because nobody actually asks me each transaction, did you forestall or were you going to do this anyway? So even when all the data's in, you won't know the answer to that question. You can only infer the best you can from the what's on the second table here.
So I mean, if we did go around, we'd have to ask all both the buyers and sellers and the people who didn't buy and sell as to what their motives were, and that would be, I guess, impossible.
Yeah, in order to separate out of a stalling effect from other things, oil prices bouncing up and down, whatever they may do, to separate those two things out. So even after the end of all the data coming in on the actuals, you still won't know whether a variation was due to forestalling or to some regular, if you like, uncertainty.
I mean, presumably at some stage we should do a study, or somebody should do a study like that, but what, should we wait 5 years maybe to do that?
Well, from an academic perspective, yes, 5 years would be fine, because then we got 5 years' worth of regular performance. From your perspective, no, you want 5 minutes, but you can't do it.
Well, maybe,
so the only thing you can do is infer. I mean, my initial, when looking at these numbers, my initial thought was that it's over by the end of August, the forestalling part. Then September sort of cut the ground underneath my feet a wee bit. October looks more back on track. So my guess, but it is a guess, is it's largely over.
Okay, thanks so much.
But then that doesn't say anything about what happens next February, March.
I mean, even if John's scenario was magically to take place and you were to ask all the buyers and sellers what their motives were, that doesn't mean they necessarily tell you, oh yeah, I did it, you actually save a few bob in tax.
Opinion polls, yeah.
Exactly. Okay, so Jackie, to be followed by Gavin.
Thank you very much. I did in fact go back and read your October 2014 report, and you actually warned there about buyer behaviour and the behaviour in response to the higher tax rates. Now, I was fascinated by that because you then went on to say, you know, as you've said already, the current kind of forecasting methodology doesn't get you there, doesn't allow you to forecast that. What needs to change and how quickly can we change to start to model some of that buyer behaviour? I'm not so much thinking about LBTT, I think in terms of wider applications with the more powers that are coming to the Parliament. I'm keen we're able to model behaviour in relation to taxation.
First go. Essentially, when you're doing economic analysis, there's a whole continuum of approaches you can follow. And typically, for short-term forecasting, you use varying degrees of sophistication, but essentially data-driven statistical techniques. So you essentially take a bunch of historical data and you try to extrapolate that in as intelligent a way as you possibly can to get a short-term forecast. And that's fine if everything is behaving as normal. But if you change policy regime, if there's a big financial crisis, if something has happened which is unusual, those techniques become less reliable. And what you can do in those kind of situations is you move away from these kind of data-driven statistical techniques, and you have to do a more formal kind of modelling, which is relies more heavily on economic theory to provide structure to the way you analyse the economy. And then you can start to look at behavioural responses to policy changes, whether the, for example, in the case of the housing market, the current forecasting technique will essentially start from historical data and move that towards some long-run average. You may, of course, have booms or busts in the housing market, and so perhaps you'll need a more sophisticated model to try and capture these booms and busts and these turning points in these booms and busts, you know, when the boom starts to crash and things like that. That requires what are called dynamic stochastic general equilibrium models, which are far more theoretically driven, can be estimated by the data. They're probably less useful for day-to-day forecasting, but they're better for analysing these policy changes, these big events in the housing market. So you want to kind of do both. You want to do this more sophisticated, more fundamental stuff to inform the evaluation of the day-to-day short-term statistical forecasting. And doing the latter takes a long time.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if anybody else has anything to add. You all agree?
I can try. I don't want to disagree with what Campbell says, because that's the correct answer. More practically, we've tried with some of these other forecasts to find out, either the Scottish Government does it or we do back-of-the-envelope calculations, to find out whether some of these behavioural factors actually have an impact on the forecast statistically. As to say, is there a robust relationship there? You find a lot of the time there's not, but this is partly because we may have the wrong definition of the variable we're using. There may be no data which is Scottish-specific as opposed to UK-wide, and if behaviour here is a wee bit different from there, then, of course, it's going to be different. I mean, these are fairly obvious points to make. It's a little bit of a hard job to actually nail it down. You want longer samples because the data... The unfortunate thing about humans is that they change their behaviour, so it's not always regular behaviour, even if some of these factors are always in there somewhere. And the other thing is, if we're talking LBTT... or one or two of the others, the speculative behaviour in there, and there's, you know, it's a huge, we're dependent on house prices, and we all know they zip up and down from time to time. It's very hard to deal with that. So I don't think we ever get a complete answer. We might get further in due course.
But I was very, you know, encouraged that you identified that as something way back in October 2014 that was of concern. Can I turn to the updated assessment and just looking at the kind of cumulative difference. The convener touched on forestalling. The OBR estimate is 20 million. Is that, in your view, a reasonable estimate, given the Scottish Government minimum and maximum? They seem to have landed in the middle.
Yeah, I think, well, at the time these estimates were given, I think the Scottish Government felt that the forestalling would likely to be more towards the lower end of their estimates than the upper end, and the OBR had this figure of 20. In the latest challenge meeting we had with the OBR and Scottish Government forecasters, the OBR was contemplating raising that estimate. So just looking at the figures in the second table we give, it does look as if there has been substantial forestalling, although we just... Given that it's tailing off from those early months, sure. It does look as though in those early months there was some substantial forestalling.
Oh, I mean, I think people would recognise that. It's the extent of it, I suppose.
Well, the
I don't know whether you're at liberty to reveal the order of magnitude of the difference between their original estimate and what they're talking about now.
Well, I think they're contemplating changing it, is my understanding. What they're contemplating changing it to, I don't know. But if you look at the cumulative difference, even after the first 4 months of data, it's 26.4 million, which would already take you above that figure of 20 million. So,
Okay. Can I explore with you then the question of tinselitis, which I find fascinating? Given the estimates of tax revenues from November to year end, do you think that's reasonable in light of what we know about seasonality?
It does. Well, if you look at the the first column, it gives you how the percentage of the annual tax revenues you should expect to receive in that month, and you can see the tinselitis effect for December. So you would get 9.8%. People trying to move in before Christmas, they complete their transactions, pay the tax, and then in January nobody moves, it drops down to 5.5%. So that effect is there. In fact, I'm going through it myself right now. So.
I was about to. Fantastic. So you think these are reasonable estimates in terms of
seasonality? Yes. I mean, it was a standard approach to adjusting for seasonality that was employed, and was consistent with.
You get excited about tinselitis, but I don't know what the equivalent for the summer holidays are. But the summer holidays effect is larger.
Yes. No. I saw that, which was quite interesting.
It's a two peak.
Yeah, because I think everybody makes the assumption that you sell more houses in the summer, but actually the reality is it's after that, indeed. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Jackie. Gavin, to be followed by Mark.
Thank you, good morning. I just want to check a difference between your first paper and your second paper, which came in last night. In your first paper, and the convener touched on this, if you have the minimal figure for forestalling, which I think is the 12 million, in your first paper you say that the estimated annualised forecast error would be 19.5 million. That's at the bottom of the table on page one of your letter. In the document you gave us last night, if you have the minimal level of forestalling of 12 million, your view now is that the estimated forecast error would be 31.1 million. So, the change is over an £11 million change in the forecast error. Now, the only difference I can see is that you very helpfully, I have to say, added in the October figures, which I'm grateful for as up-to-date as possible. But when I look at your October numbers, we expected 21.3 million in revenues. We got 20 million in revenues. So we're 1.3 million down. But by being 1.3 million down in a single month, suddenly your forecast error has shot up. Can you explain that?
There was an error in the previous table. It was kind of, we lifted the 20 million forestalling figure from the spreadsheets and labelled it as the 12 million forestalling figure. So it's simply a mistransposed figure, which we apologise for.
So the
minimum forestalling figure in the original paper was actually a 20 million forestalling figure, not a 12 million forestalling figure. That was mislabelled.
Okay, so the estimated error shouldn't have been 19.5 million. Is that, it should have been higher than 19?
Yeah, it would be closer to the 31.1 million that is in the revised figure.
Okay, that's it.
And because everything is being scaled up from the annualisation, if it's 60%, that's not quite as far as doubling the error. Because there's an error in you've identified, and then you put that into the annual total, you divide by 0.6, which is nearly two times. Right, so that's an unavoidable thing because we don't have enough. We don't have the end of the year's data.
But the simple explanation is that there was an error in the
paper. Yeah, yeah, right about that.
I'm
just warning because that's
the updated paper and ignore the early.
So the original paper for the 12 million forestalling, it should have been an error of 30.8, and now it's 31.1.
Okay, that's it.
And we do apologise about that, but we did catch it. So
yeah, sure. Okay, thank you. In terms of the next question then, I mean, the two figures on both papers, the OBR one is 20, which has been out there publicly. I mean, when I've reviewed documents, and this is in the Spice paper, I hadn't noticed the 12 million and the 37 million pound figures published before. Now, are you able to just give us some background of where those figures come from? And do you intend to... Are they your workings or are they Scottish Government workings?
Government workings. So where they come from is there's an academic paper by two authors, Best and Claven, which looked at the impact of the stamp duty holiday that was introduced in about 2008 and so on. So that kind of reduced stamp duty tax rates temporarily, kind of indicated they would be reduced for a certain period of time, then extended that period of time, and then they went back up again. So you have the kind of natural experiment of tax rates coming down, then being reapplied. So it can give you a measure of these forestalling effects to some extent. So the Scottish, we encourage the Scottish Government to look into this paper and look at Scottish data, plots of Scottish data around these key events, and to look at both the magnitude of the effect and how quickly it dissipated. And the range of estimates that come out, this 12 to 37 million, capture the kind of a range of estimates as to the magnitude of the behavioural effect and how long it lasts. That's where it comes from.
I'm grateful for the explanation. I mean, is that something you're at liberty to publish, or is that something I would need to ask the Scottish Government to put in terms of the workings behind? Because just plonking the figures down there is marginally helpful, but it doesn't tell the whole picture. Is it something you're allowed to publish, or is it something I should ask?
I think
the
it's
Minister?
A Scottish Government document, so that they would have to publish it.
Okay, fair enough. I can obviously ask the Minister more about that, but to your knowledge, is that a net figure? And what I mean by a net figure is, obviously, in terms of the tax changes, we know that some transactions were pushed through quickly ahead of April in order to reduce the tax bill. We know to a lesser extent, but there's certainly evidence from a number of sources to us, that some transactions were delayed because the threshold was 145 instead of what it is in the UK. And so, therefore, presumably there's some kind of balancing act between the two, coupled with, again, as you identified well over a year ago, there would be some behavioural impact potentially in the medium to longer term anyway if you increase the tax rate. So there's a couple of factors at play there. And my question is, to your knowledge, the 12 to 37, is that taking into account all of those factors, or is that simply looking at transactions that were rushed through before April?
It's looking at the impact on the kind of 2015-16 tax take. So it's the net effect of the tax regime change on revenues raised in 2015-16. So it's all those transactions that didn't take place, possibly because they occurred before March. So it's not adding back in any revenue gained prior to the fiscal year. It's also not including any permanent behavioural effects. It's purely an estimate of forestalling, which is that temporary phenomenon.
If I go on to the sort of page two then of your updated report, I mean, you've outlined the months there from April through to March. You've outlined percentages for what the expected tax revenues are. I mean, just take April, for example. On what basis did we think that we would get 7.5% of the tax in April? Was that based on averaging 5 years? Was it based on just the previous year? Where did that 7.5 figure, for example, come from?
Well, it's essentially based on looking at the seasonality that you observe in both house prices and in transactions in the housing market. So it looks at historical data for prices, looks at historical data for transactions, runs this technique called X12, which is the kind of standard way that statistical agencies seasonally adjust data so that you can decompose the historical path of data into trends, cycles, and seasonality. So this is identifying the seasonality bit. And what it says is the combined effect of prices being lower and transactions being lower in April mean that you expect relatively low amount of tax to be generated in April, and the combined effect of lots of transactions and prices being more buoyant in July, you get a lot more tax in July.
Seasonality point. I was just trying to make sure that we weren't basing these on, say, for example, 1 year's figures. This is
a longer time series to apply these things.
Okay, that's helpful. So what's the next question then? And this is one where I'm a bit perplexed. On page two, you've headed it up, updated assessment of forestalling, and you've looked at the months for the financial year so far. What you haven't done, or at least what you haven't put out here, is look at January, February and March of 2015, because, you know, by definition, forestalling is a transaction that takes place in advance of a deadline. And surely if we're going to have any idea of actually what happened in relation to forestalling, we can't possibly have any idea if we don't look very, very closely at what happened between the announcements of the tax rates and the actual the tax rates actually starting to bite. So why have we not published anything in the months leading up to April?
We haven't looked at that. The original Best and Claven paper suggests that these effects may not actually be symmetric. So just by looking at what happens before, you cannot necessarily imply that the forestalling that you observe afterwards is the mirror image of that. There seems to be an asymmetry. So you may get some transactions rushed forward, and you may just see temporarily more transactions just don't happen at all. So it could be that doesn't actually tie down the level of forestalling you actually get.
Yes, on that, we don't have the actuals under the old regime, and we don't know how much the regime shift. I don't mean tax rates, I mean from one type of tax to another type of tax, the old stamp duty one. So it's a bit difficult to do. But what I can tell you, because I did it this morning over coffee at breakfast time, very quickly, this is a back of the envelope calculation, that from the numbers I got out of the evidence from your previous witnesses, and conditional on that, at a rough average of the LBDT system, about £56 million worth was shifted before April. Right, so it's not symmetric, as Campbell says, but there is clear evidence on the basis, they've got numbers on how much transactions went up and how much house prices went up, so you can put that together and see what the net increase was over what you might otherwise have expected. Yeah, so that's a very rough idea.
I'm grateful for that. I mean, I wasn't suggesting, Professor Leith, that it would necessarily be symmetric, but I don't see how you can do a sensible forestalling exercise by completely ignoring what happened before. I mean, if for example, in the lead-up to the tax, transactions and tax collecting were exactly as expected, then presumably these differences that we're seeing here are down to something else entirely. So I just don't understand how you could ignore it completely.
There is substantial evidence that transactions did go up before it, certainly in the kind of the brackets, the tax bands that were most affected. We haven't quantified the effect here. But, I mean, another way of looking at it is that you should, if it is purely forestalling, you should see the effects trickle out towards the end of the year. So that's another way of assessing it, and that's the approach we essentially followed.
Could I just assure you that we've discussed this point. You're absolutely right to raise it. We haven't ignored it. We've discussed it, but haven't had the data in the detail. I mean, you have to compare by tax band as well, and so it's slightly more complicated than just the sum of money, but the sum of revenue that Andrew has stated is at least a guidepost. One other factor that also complicates it, and we don't really have information on this, is whether house prices change in the circumstances. So if people with houses they had hoped to put on the market in certain bands are then worried about selling, that might change. So it is rather more complex, but the point is well taken and something that we will continue to look at.
I'm grateful for that. And just and finally, in terms of the forestalling exercise, because certainly in my mind there's been a bit of confusion here, who, from a Scottish perspective, who is leading on this? Is it the Scottish Government leading on it and doing all the work and asking you to review it? Or are they asking you to basically do the work and show them your workings? How, in terms of, I mean, there might not be an obvious answer, but it's not clear to me whether it's you leading or them leading, and I just wonder what your interpretation is of it.
The Scottish Government did the work to produce the £12 to £37 million estimate. That was, we recommended that they looked at the best enclaven paper in doing so, and then we reviewed extensively the work they were doing and kind of critique it in the usual way we do, as in the style of an academic seminar. They presented their work, we asked lots and lots of questions, get very picky with everything to toughen up that forecast.
Could I just go back to the wording of your question? The Scottish Government hasn't, and I would not expect them to ask us to do work, which they would then incorporate. I mean, that is not appropriate, I think, as far as we're concerned. But what we do is challenge along the way, and in terms of the best enclaven paper, it was to say we wanted to see a somewhat more sophisticated view and therefore recommended that they take that forward. They didn't have to, but they did do it.
Okay. And just finally, in terms of going forward, in your entry at the moment, is there a specific task, is there a task being given to you to look more at forestalling, or is it a case of you'll wait until the Scottish Government come back to you?
Well, you've given us that task, I think, so we would acknowledge that, Campbell.
Yeah, I think, well, the table we currently have is incomplete, and as more data emerges, we will fill up that table. That will give us a lot of information. And again, as resources come on stream for the Fiscal Commission, as we extend the depth of the modelling work we're looking at, then this is potentially looking at more behavioural effects in the housing market is an obvious area for us to explore.
Just before I let Mark in, I mean, you've said that the maximum forecast error is likely to be £31.1 million, but the cumulative difference on your table is already £31.6 million. And every month so far, the difference has been higher. You know, it's varied from £10.6 million to £0.1 million. So what makes you think that every other month isn't going to be exactly the same? You seem to have, concluded that somehow the cumulative difference is going to be down to £31.1 million. So we've not been given any workings about how you actually produce these estimates. So I'm just wondering how you seem to think that everything in the second half of the year is going to be much rosier and get down to that maximum of £31.1 million, which in itself is not exactly good news.
I can explain. So the original forecast of 235 is a forecast before forestalling. And the forecast errors are therefore the forecast errors having added back your estimated effects of forestalling, so it's the forecast error relative to a world without forestalling. That's the, if you see
right,
what I mean.
Okay.
So that would, we hope, help us and yourselves understand the strength or the reasonableness of the forecast methodology. Forestalling makes it harder to understand in this first year.
Yeah. So your headline forecast figure that we're asked to evaluate is the 235 figure, which
yes,
is a figure which doesn't include forestalling.
Right, okay.
Therefore,
right, okay.
In assessing that, we adjust the outturn figures to add back in any estimates of forestalling, and then we project that forward for the year and compare that to the forecast to get the forecast out.
Okay.
It may be relevant later on this morning, but is this an illustration of how we work in the sense that we've got a forecast here which came out of the Scottish Government and we have to assess, and that's a forecast without forestalling in it, we have to assess that's reasonable. If we then, you would normally just compare that to the actuals as they come out, but the actuals have had the forecasting taken out of it, so in order to be able to assess the Scottish Government's original forecast, we've got to put them back in. That adds errors into it, obviously, because the forecasting of the forestalling, trouble with the words there, but forecasting the forestalling adds errors into it. And so I could differentiate myself slightly from my colleagues on that, because this is after we go past next April, when the actual numbers are in on the actual outturns, we'll turn out to have been assessing something that nobody's interested in anyway, because it's a counterfactual. It's something which is never going to happen. Forestalling is actually there. That raises a whole stack of questions. But what we're doing here, of course, is we're making a kind of forecast of what we think the end of the year would look like had there been no forestalling, as a, if you like, aid de memoir, or I hesitate to use your word of benchmark, but it's a kind of calculation for checking whether what the Scottish Government is doing is about right, even if, in the event next year, we'll be talking about a completely different set of numbers. It makes a lot of, there are a lot of assumptions in there, okay. Inevitably.
Yeah, understandably. Okay, thanks for that, Mark, to be followed by Richard.
Yeah, so just to bottom that out, at the moment, the cumulative difference, if you were to factor in for stalling, would be, so 31.6 just now, if you were to take the 12 million figure, you'd be looking at 19.6 instead of where you are right now, if you were to add in the forestalling effect to the cumulative difference at present.
So the second table, that cumulative difference, what it does is it projects how much tax we would expect to receive given seasonality and assuming there's no forestalling. We then compare that with the actuals in the second table, and that can give you implicitly possibly a measure of forestalling. Or it could be these permanent effects, or it could be some other effect. So that cumulative difference, if you took that to be your estimate of forestalling, and then went back to table one and redid the calculation, and assumed that all those effects had now finished at the end of October, the rest of the year was just going to proceed with the seasonality you would normally expect, with no further forestalling, then you would have a forecast error of effectively zero.
Yeah, that I think is where I was.
The crucial question is: has forestalling finished or not?
Yes. I wanted to go back to the question that Gavin Brown asked about the comparison of sort of the months leading up from when the bans were announced, and I guess my question around that would be: how easy is it to get hold of that data, given that one would assume
if it were possible to disaggregate Scottish data from the HMRC figures, then the OBR would have come up with a very different forecast because they would have been able to look at Scottish data as opposed to what they appeared to have done for their forecast, which is just to extrapolate from the UK-wide figure. So just wonder if you have any indication of how easy or otherwise it would be to get hold of that first 3 months of the year in terms of Scottish data.
Very difficult. Sorry, I don't know if you were asking me or him, but I would have thought it would be very difficult because HMRC doesn't release its data very easily. And the earlier period would be HMRC data because Revenue Scotland wasn't operating at that point. So in this particular case, it might be rather difficult.
Okay. And then just to ask you a purely hypothetical question. Obviously, we had evidence just before you came from Scottish Property Federation, who've said that they think the tax rates should be changed, and that's something that should be announced by the Deputy First Minister as part of his budget. I wonder if, from your perspective, we might then you might consider we would see a different effect rather than purchases and sales being brought forward, of purchases and sales potentially being delayed before that change comes into effect, and that could have a knock-on impact on the expected revenues and the actual revenues in the sort of January, February, March months.
If people start expecting a tax cut, then the forestalling effect works in reverse. So, yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you, Commissioner. Really, it's just a question on clarity on the question which Gavin Brown asked you at the end of his period of questioning, and that's just to be clear about what these figures actually represent. I mean, is this a situation where you've received, quite rightly, data from the Scottish Government and applied your own methodologies to come up with the forecast, or is this in effect the Commission analysing the reasonableness of the figures and the forecast, and therefore in effect the figures are a Scottish Government forecast in terms of LBTT revenues?
Perhaps, well, the 235 figure is the government forecast for LBTT before forestalling. The 12 to 37 figure is the Scottish Government's forecast estimate of the extent of forestalling as well. The rest of the analysis is essentially just taking the outturn data that we have to date and trying to sensibly adjust that to account for both seasonality and this range of estimates of forestalling effects, to try and then infer what we might expect outturn numbers to be for the rest of the year as a basis of comparison with the forecast.
Is it the Commission's carried out rather than the Scottish Government?
That's right.
Yes.
Okay,
so
this is a forecast by the Commission then, and if we ask ministers here to explain their estimates, their accounts and their figures, we could potentially expect a different set of figures and forecasts from the one that you've brought forward today in this analysis.
Yeah, so essentially what we're doing for this exercise is extrapolating the part year outturn numbers to make them a sensible annual outturn number. So it's a very short run extrapolation of outturn numbers. It's not a forecast in the same way as the Scottish Government is forecasting for the next year what LBTT revenues will be.
Asked the Scottish Government if they to make an extrapolation on the same basis. Do you think they would use similar models, similar analyses, or is that something you're aware of, or could it be potentially very different?
This is the way we would do it.
They could be.
Okay, they would choose their own way to do it.
Yeah. That's great. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now, at this point, I would normally have a break, but we've got the same set of witnesses. I'm just wondering if colleagues would prefer for us just to plough on. Okay, happy with that, or would you like a break, witnesses? Okay, we'll have a 2-minute break for witnesses.
I shall reconvene the meeting. We're still on agenda item 3. We'll now hear from members of the Fiscal Commission on a separate topic, which is our consideration of the Scottish Fiscal Commission Bill at Stage 1. Members have received a written submission from Leah Rice, and I invite her to make her second opening statement of the day.
Thank you very much. You're gluttons for punishment, obviously. So let me say again first that we're very grateful for the chance to respond. This is clearly an extremely important piece of legislation in our eyes, and appreciate the chance to come here and discuss our views. We noted and have read some of the responses to the consultation which the committee received in writing, and were interested in how broad the range of views and perspectives were. There clearly is not one right way to do this, and I think that is an important point to make, that we should here in Scotland choose the right way for Scotland to shape the Commission, but it was interesting to see that breadth of viewpoints. We've also given a lot of thought to these issues, in particular forecasting, which has been raised by the committee and by others a number of times, and also the issue of independence, particularly the fact that we need to be not just acting independently, which we believe we are, but that we need to be seen to be independent. And some of our propositions in our response were based in trying to address that particular issue. In terms of forecasting, could I make one point, which is that it's a word. As a banker, I used to despair at the fact that everybody called everything a bank, and some things are banks and some aren't, but the language allows you to use the word widely. Well, forecasting is a little bit like that as well. And when we talk about forecasting, there are the official forecasts, which in today's world are done by the Scottish Government. But forecasting is also a tool, and I think, Richard, you were beginning to get at that with our table on forestalling. So forecasting is a tool along with analysis and research that can help inform debate and help inform our judgments. So it's almost forecasting with a capital F and forecasting with a small f. And I just want to state that distinction very clearly. Some of the topics raised in your call for responses to your questions obviously relate to matters that will come out of the fiscal framework. We've tried to address them, although more briefly, because we don't know what will, nor does anyone just now, know what will be the final outcome in the development of the fiscal framework. But once we do, in terms of whether there is a charter or fiscal rules or what the borrowing arrangements might be, we could expand our perspective there. But we've just given you some general responses. And in general, overall, I should say, our views are in the submission, so I will close my opening statement and we're happy to take your questions.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Now, this, I'm going to try and have a self-denying ordinance because there's so many things I can ask, and Gavin shakes his head there, but I shall try and limit myself to a number.
Can we
of
exercise a self-denying ordinance in terms of our responses? No.
Certainly not. Certainly not. Just for that cheek, I could make keep you here to tea time. No. Certainly not. I'm going to ask you something which you probably don't expect to be asked first of all, because it's near the end of your submission. But I thought I'd start off with something like this rather than go delve into the other areas which you no doubt will be asked a considerable number of questions on, such as forecasting. But you said that the term of office should be stated in the bill, and the SFC believes on the whole that a single non-renewable term as currently pertains is effective and that individual terms should be staggered. I was quite surprised by that, because a lot of our witnesses suggested that for issues of continuity, they did agree with staggering, but perhaps two terms members should serve. I mean, has it been that onerous so far?
I'll tell you that later. No. We discussed it, and actually we could be persuaded in different directions, but the point was, in setting us up, there was a strong view, and we subscribed to that view, that we should take on this role without any feeling in our own minds that, oh, we'd like another term, so that might color even subconsciously our responses or the work that we do. There is real value in having one term. The length of term can be shorter or longer. We do think staggered terms are important. Some of the respondents who have said they're should be two terms have also perhaps believed that there may be a dearth of other qualified and able people. I suppose I personally take a view that Scotland, with its 13 or 14 or 15 universities, the UK with a great deal of talent, and more widely, that we should actually be able to find people of talent. But we also discussed two terms possibly, as long as there was a process for renewal, or possibly a term, a break of 2 years, and then a return as well. Which isn't necessarily guaranteed. So we wouldn't, you know, stake our feet to the ground on the one term, but we see the advantage of it, and we have no debate with it for ourselves.
So you would consider the President Putin approach of a term of office followed by a gap, and then by popular demand coming back to the SFC. Okay, and I'm going to again talk about something different, which is additional functions. I mean, you've said in page three, you said the SFC believes it should have responsibility for assessing the Scottish Government's forecasts on the sustainability of Scotland's public finances. Such a adherence to fiscal rules is an example, and would welcome the bill being amended now to anticipate this additional responsibility when it arises. And I'm sure that that paragraph will be welcomed by a number of our witnesses who have given evidence so far, and some of the submissions, indeed, I'm sure, members of the committee as well. I'm just wondering if you can talk us through a wee bit more on your thinking on that particular issue.
I've been asked to give evidence several times to the committee, both prior to the Fiscal Commission being created. And one of the main objectives of creating a Fiscal Commission is to ensure fiscal sustainability. So that's this kind of raison d'etre of a Fiscal Commission, is to do exactly that.
Okay, right. So
Yes, I could go on at length about that as well, but and have in the past. If you take the view which is in the remit of as the bill is written at the moment, that the Commission should look at and comment on information revenues that the Scottish Government may use to make up its budget, then, of course, I think at a minimum you have to worry about fiscal sustainability. And, of course, I'm not quite sure what that means at the moment, because that means sustainability against the rules which it has in place, which means at the moment the borrowing is minimal, so it's not a big operation at the moment, but it might be different in some other context. So that's one part of the minimum, which is not explicitly in the bill, and it might help if it were. And the second one is sensitivity analysis. It'd be rather difficult to say, we think this forecast is reasonable, without having poked it a little bit to see whether it stands up against shocks of different sorts or slightly different outcomes in the rest of the economy. So sensitivity analysis ought to be in there, and I think, again, it would help if it were nominated, so that everybody knew that it was going to be one of the things that you looked at.
Now, one of the things that actually came up was just what you've touched on there, Professor Hughes Hallett, which is obviously the issue of reasonableness. You know, we had some discussions about that, as you've known from evidence. And what's your view of what reasonableness is? I mean, if Scottish government, you know, suggests, I mean, how do you define whether a forecast is reasonable or not? I think that was something that we tried to get to grip with, and a lot of our witnesses had some issues with in previous sessions, as you'll be aware.
And I wonder whether you get any reasonable response.
Let's see if we get one.
I don't like trying to define it, because it's one of those things like, you know, the prime rate, what's that? Well, it's what we say it is. And I think Alice in Wonderland has something on that in that regard. So defining it precisely is rather difficult. The next thing that people tend to do is have a checklist. You know, does it satisfy this? Does it satisfy that? And that... And the most obvious is, in looking ex post, was it accurate? Is the obvious thing to do there. That has a place in all of this. The one thing I would caution is that don't be too prescriptive about that sort of thing, because in the attempt to make something very objective instead of subjective, you find it very difficult to introduce any judgment. And of course, in the forecasts, you have to have some judgment as to what's likely to happen in the future. And so I wouldn't be too prescriptive about it. And by way of illustration, with indulgence on my left, the American SAT scores for getting into university was an attempt to say what's a reasonable performance, and it was done with checklists. And what you observe now is most universities don't use it, because it was too inflexible. So I'll give you a different answer, having said that much, and that is, what do we actually do? And this is why I was raising in the LBTT case the way we're trying to assess the forecasts by not producing official forecasts, but doing our own calculations to see whether we would do something similar. So to start off with, if we look at specific scenarios on the tax, I'm saying this is the way we go about establishing reasonableness, to check the methodology, if that's okay, whether there are things left out, whether there are specific economic factors that should be taken into account and haven't been, those sorts of things. Are the assumptions sensible right up front of the forecasts? People often pick on the example we had last year with the non-domestic rates being over-optimistic. It wasn't that we changed the forecast. What we changed was an unreasonable assumption up front. So we do that in the first stage, those sorts of things. You can, difficult in this case perhaps, not impossible, check against other forecasts available. Of course, the OBR forecasts are available all the time, so we can check against them. I'm beginning to get the feeling that maybe that's not a huge amount of competition because they do it on an UK basis, and if Scotland's a bit different, then something else will happen. And then the third thing is to do the simple calculation, and I emphasise this, simple calculation is not a forecast, to back up our position. Would I get a, if I did it myself rather simply, would I get a similar kind of number, not the same, but a similar kind of number? And this is the point, if it's different, then you can try and dive in there and see why would it be different? What was it? And you should learn something from what was wrong. That will help you decide whether what they were putting out is reasonable or not. We're not going to then say we're going to change the number, or you should change the number, and we say I think a different process would be a good idea, or a bit of extra information. So that's how it's being done. I'm sorry, it's a bit rather waffly answer. But
well, actually, so I found it very helpful. But ultimately, when you do come to a number, I mean, if you look at the Scottish Government's figures and you think, well, we don't really think they're maybe as accurate as they should be, when does it become unreasonable? It's 1%, 5%, 10% of a differential. I mean, how would...
They were last year.
Right, okay, so you wouldn't pin down
I wouldn't, then. No, because circumstances are different. You get into recession, that your 1% is out of the window.
Yeah.
Right,
sure. So I'm not suggesting it should be 1%, I'm just saying what the Scottish Fiscal Commission think would be reasonable.
This is a judgment factor coming in.
Right, okay.
Yeah. So I think it's really important just to emphasise Andrew's point that this is not a matter simply of metricization of metrics, that it is judgment and numbers. And the judgment is really important. So if we went through the rational or intellectual exercise of saying, in this particular case, for this particular tax, we would ourselves expect to look at A, B, C, D, E, F, whatever those things are. If we found that the Scottish Government team had not looked at any but perhaps one or two of those factors, we might find it difficult to say, well, their forecast is rational, not because we're judging the numbers they came out with, but because of the approach taken. And so that is all about judgment, and that is the kind of thing that comes out in our challenge meetings.
Okay, now in your paper, on page 2, you talk about transparency, and you say in order to ensure transparency at every stage, the SFC would publish minutes of its meetings with the Scottish Government. But, I mean, transparency takes a number of forms. I mean, for example, we had in a previous session, we talked about forestalling, but we didn't have any detail, for example, from you of how you worked, the work you did to actually come up with these numbers. And Andrew's just touched on non-domestic rates. I mean, the figures for the original forecast were not provided, so it's not really possible for us to identify how much it was changed, and it's also not clear why this recommendation led to a change in the official forecast while our Scottish Fiscal Commission recommendations didn't. For example, the SFC recommended the need to account for behavioural responses in producing forecasts for residential LBTT. But the report doesn't mention whether this was raised with Scottish Government as part of the process of inquiry and challenging what, if any, response was provided. And there's no mention of this in the Scottish Government's own methodology paper. So, I mean, transparency is not, I would think, surely goes a lot deeper than just producing minutes of meetings and decisions made.
Yeah, well, the production of the minutes, now that we have a bit of support, is one aspect of transparency. We publish our work, comments on our activities and so forth on our website, all of which is expanding over time. We're also learning what it is that you consider transparency, and I think this is a learning process for us as well. So if you're wanting to have a lot of the detail behind a table, we can provide that. But in a way, we're new to this, and in terms of what your expectations might be. So we're very happy to take guidance and advice about what it is you do want. But overall, in terms of transparency, that matters greatly. I mean, there's no point in having any of these debates or discussions without being quite open about what we're basing things on. We might be wrong on things as well, and you know, it might be others come to us and say, actually, you're off base in looking at this or that. That could only happen if we were transparent. So we're looking for ways to increase that transparency, to increase our overall communications, and we're happy to take any pointers you give us.
Just add a little point to that as well. In the kind of the medium to longer term as well, we've already begun a number of kind of what could be called research projects, which are looking at more deeply at different aspects of the modelling of some of these taxes. And we asked for provisions in the bill to allow us to publish technical working papers, which that would then allow us on an ad hoc basis to publish the details of that research. So that would also contribute to the transparency of what we do.
Okay, that again is helpful. Now, in your paper, you said in terms of right of access to information, memorandum of understanding of the normal way of working across public sector areas, if the SFE's right to establish relevant MOUs would be better safeguarded with more explicit wording in the face of the bill, then the SFC would support doing so. So I take it you would be quite keen for that to happen, actually, on the face of the bill then.
You're
really tentative in your wording there. I'm just to see if I can push you further.
MOUs appear to be the way to establish good working relationships, but actually, the ultimate good working relationship depends on the people and the goodwill involved. So MOUs alone, and perhaps that is reflected in the tentativeness of the wording, as you said, MOUs alone don't ensure what we want to achieve, but they certainly help, and they set out the boundaries and the fencing around what it is that we might do. So just so you know, that we developed an MOU with Revenue Scotland specifically for the data we needed to analyse in relation to the outturns paper we did. They were extremely helpful. We're now in conversation with them to develop what I might call, probably not your language, but a perpetual MOU, so that we don't have to do one each time we go to them with a request for information. So we do think it's helpful to have those in place, yes.
And I take it you're hoping to develop those with the HMRC and the OBR, because you say over time, and in order to do its job properly, the SFC's goal would be to have a deeper relationship with OBR and HMRC.
Yeah, and the import of that statement is, once the new powers are finally agreed and come to Scotland, new taxes and other related matters, over time, it will be more and more important to have those connections and have them formalized. But let me also say that the OBR have been very, their doors have been open really from the beginning. They've been very cooperative and supportive, and have invited us into their challenge meetings when they've been looking at Scottish taxes last year, over the summer as well. So we have joined those, and we have had access to their working and their thinking along the way, and we have provided some challenges back there as well. So in a way, some of that is happening. The MOU doesn't make it happen, or doesn't make it happen perfectly, but we think it is a useful tool, and therefore we wrote that statement.
Okay, thank you. And the last point I want to touch on before opening out to colleagues around the table is obviously forecasting. I mean, you've said in your report, for example, that you're looking to have better interaction, direct engagement, contact with the forecasters. The SFC could have direct engagement with the forecasters in the early part of the year when forecasters are developing and refining their models. Your role would be to challenge and influence the efficacy of Scottish Government process and approaches. And you've talked about being in a rational world, there should be one official forecast of tax revenues and an independent assessment of that forecast. These activities should lead to a check on the official forecast, but not become the basis in themselves for informing the draft budget. And of course you say, and that your position has been quite consistent throughout, I have to say on this, the SFC as the assessor believes it should develop the latter type of forecasts alongside research modelling and analysis. But you'll obviously be aware, you know, and I'm going to quote you some of the comments here, as you would expect me to do, that most of the witnesses we have are not of that view. They take the view that basically the SFC should be producing its own forecast. So, for example, the Royal Society of Edinburgh are, and I quote, firmly of the view that the SFC should be able to originate its own independent forecast of the future fiscal revenues, and indeed to fulfil its functions, the SFC will need to be able to produce independent forecasts. Professor McGregor and Professor Swales point out that international practice suggests that fiscal bodies not provide their own forecasts they typically have access to sufficiently detailed independent forecasts. And the Canadian Parliamentary Budget Officer states that if the SFC produces its own forecast, this will allow Parliament to challenge the assumptions underlying the Scottish Government forecast. And finally, and there's loads of these, but I won't read them all out, of course, Dr Armstrong and Dr Lissenkover argue that the SFC should prepare their own independent forecast on the basis that producing a forecast greatly adds to discipline. So I'm just wondering why it is, given there are so many commentators, and not all of them, of course, I mean, there's ICAST and others, who don't take that view, but the general thrust among your academic colleagues, for example, is that the SFC should produce its own forecast. So why are you continuing to take the view that you should really comment in the Scottish Government?
A number of topics that would pertain in terms of a response. Let me start, and I'll turn to both my colleagues as well, because we've talked about this a great deal. If we produce, this gets back to my opening statement earlier about the official forecast and forecasts, and I wonder whether some of those comments that you've quoted have to do with forecasts in the sense that amongst our toolbox, we should be able to produce forecasts, possibly for some taxes at certain points in time, for certain elements. It's our choice where we think we need to see that, and in a way, you referred already to the work on forestalling as being a sort of mini forecast. And we think that is part of what should be in our toolkit, along with the ability to do analysis, to do some technical papers and research, as Campbell has pointed out. That is different from producing the official forecast. We think there needs to be one producer of the official forecast and an assessor of that forecast. Now, if you turn to the Fiscal Commission and said, well, actually, we've changed our minds, you do the official forecast, we would need to be assessed by someone. If we were to do the entire forecast ourselves, then we're really duplicating what the government is doing, and that doesn't seem to make a whole lot of sense in terms of value for money. If we did our own forecast and needed to defend it, we might then be biased as well. So we've had a conversation about a lot of these elements, but it is that we believe there should be an official forecast. Right now, it's done by the Scottish Government. That needs to be assessed. That is our role, and we should not be doing an official forecast as well. I'll turn to either or both of my colleagues. Yeah.
I think, well, my view on this, it really goes back to some of the issues we already discussed in relation to types of economic forecasting, types of economic analysis. So the Scottish Government currently has to produce the forecast. It uses essentially statistical models based on historical data to do short-term projections of that data. If we were to produce an alternative or to produce the official forecast, we would, on a day-to-day basis, we would probably have to replicate that style of modelling. I don't think there's a great deal of added value in having the Fiscal Commission replicate that kind of modelling. Where I think the value added would be is if we do deeper, more fundamental projects which delve more deeply into behavioural aspects, results of policy change, bits of analysis of the economy which are not currently featured in the forecasting methods. And we need to do these depending on economic circumstances, because sometimes some issues will be more relevant than others. And that's the point in which we need to do that piece of analysis and bring it to the fore in order to effectively evaluate the quality of the short-term forecast. So I would give us the role of doing this portfolio of research. We're not just sitting there twiddling our fingers when we're not doing an official forecast. We're doing lots of bits of research which are really fundamentally going at the heart of what's driving the official forecast.
Okay. Yeah. Andrew, you want to come in?
Yes, at length. What Campbell said is right. So that's one aspect of it. So I'm not going to comment on that further. That's absolutely right. I would suggest my reading of what's going on is slightly different from yours. There are some people saying we should be doing forecasts, and there are plenty of people saying we should not. One of them is the IMF, and I think it's well worth listening to the IMF. They have oversight of these kinds of commissions everywhere else. There are not many of the regional level as opposed to the sovereign level. But so that is the case. When you look at the numbers, there are, I think, 2 out of 23 in the OECD which are doing forecasts as the official forecasts and nothing else. There's a question of second opinions. That's to say, we're doing a kind of second opinion exercise. The government producing the forecasts, as they will anyway, and we're doing the second opinion. And I go back to very old experience of mine in the Netherlands when the Central Plan Bureau was doing the forecast, and it was the only one doing the forecast, and the constant complaint all the time is, we don't know whether to believe it or not, we would like to see some second or third opinions and other features. So I think that aspect is important. And that, doing that way round, it gives us here the freedom to compare with other forecasts. And there aren't many, and there's the OBR, and there may be, I mean, when Smith comes in, there'll probably be a new industry, what one would assume, in doing that sort of thing. So that's an important aspect. And then if I'm going to depart from my colleagues at all, and I don't know if I'm actually departing with them, it's just something they haven't said, I think being asked to do the forecasting, the official forecasts, ourselves was seriously compromise our independence. You imagine how you do these forecasts, you've got to get data, you've got to talk to, and we don't have access to all the data in the world, we're going to have to talk to other people, so you're going to have to share some knowledge of what you're trying to do at that point. If we were then to put forward one forecast as the official forecast favoured over other possibilities, and you've seen when we were talking earlier that there are a lot of alternatives at any one point, that's going to leave the perception in the world that the policies which underlie that particular forecast are the ones which are favoured. So in some sense, we're prejudicing the discussion. An important point I didn't realise in talking to OBR people a month ago is that when in their operation, they're doing the official forecasts, of course, the Treasury often comes along with a proposition and they say, we're going to think you're making the following policy change. Here are our projections. What do you think of those? Now, it's natural enough that they would want to do that because they don't want to be slapped down by the OBR saying total rubbish a bit later on. But, of course, you know, the Chinese walls have been broken down and the influence is seeping in at that point. And having outsiders having no influence over independent forecasts made by us does not guarantee that they don't try and influence the commentaries. It's one thing to have an independent forecast, it's quite another thing to have an independent commentary attached. And the OBR has got problems with that. So these are various different possibilities which suggest that the independence will be compromised by us doing that. The other way around, which is what we're doing at the moment, is a different matter altogether, because we take what we're given and we say, is this reasonable or not? And maybe we haven't published enough, but here are the reasons why. We can make a judgment at that point and people can take the judgment or dislike it as they wish.
Could I just add a final comment, a personal view based on informal and other conversations I've had, is that I think that there will develop over time, as you might expect, a bit of an industry in Scotland of think tanks or university bodies or whatever doing their own version of forecasts or delving into some of these areas as well. Some of the comments you've had from others is, well, there's nothing else to refer to, you know, what else is out there? I think that will develop over time. It's not surprising that it hasn't developed yet because the devolved taxes are so new. This is almost a market thing that I think will happen.
Okay, thank you.
An extra one, sorry. This is an enduring conversation, but an extra point. I hadn't realised that when the OBR was set up and given an exclusive forecasting only mandate, give or take a little sensitivity analysis and so on, but it's on the forecasts, official forecasts, that this was done in securing the knowledge that the IFS would do the further analysis. That doesn't exist in Scotland, and if you didn't allow us to poke about and think of other factors that should be important in there and that sort of thing, but we had to make the official forecast. then I think we'd be in a worse place.
Okay, I'm keen to probe further, but I did say there's self-denying ordinance, and I know a lot of colleagues want to come in, so the first one to ask questions will be Richard, to be followed by Jackie.
Thank you, Convener. So, just to be clear, I mean, the Scottish Government has informed the committee that there'll be no restriction placed on the Commission to engage in forecasting for which to do so, that there's no nothing in legislation which would stop the Commission from engaging in forecasting, but as it stands, you've got no intention of actually engaging in any forecasting, independent forecasting yourselves, as part of the practice of assessing the reasonableness of the Scottish Government's own forecasts.
If you don't mind, go back to the forecasting with the lowercase f. Yes, we will be, and we have started doing that kind of thing. So, yes, we are engaging in forecasting as an exercise. That is absolutely something that we will do. What we're saying that we ought not to do is to somehow develop an alternate official forecast. That it doesn't make sense and would compromise our ability then to assess the official forecast that there is.
So we're doing lots of pieces of economic analysis. We've got lots of projects starting up, but we don't plan to replicate item by item the entire set of Scottish Government forecasts.
And of course, there'll be a learning process of Parliament too in terms of scrutinising the work you're carrying out in assessing reasonableness. But in terms of some of the international comparison, for example, we've looked at the Swedish example as well, which I know you've studied, and their fiscal council doesn't produce its own forecasts, but they have a National Institute of Economic Research producing its own forecasts. They've got very many bodies assessing, producing their own forecast figures. And that means there can be a very lively public debate about, therefore, how accurate the government's forecasts are, how close are they to National Institute of Economic Research's figures. I mean, isn't it therefore beneficial to have those kind of comparisons out there? And given the fact that as things stand currently, it may change in the future, but may not, there is a dearth of separate forecasts from Scottish Government figures. It would be beneficial for perhaps the Commission to consider taking on a greater forecasting role than currently is in your mind.
That's a fair point that you want. This is sort of just not second opinion, but third opinion and fourth opinion and so on. And you make some comparison. I think our comparative advantage would be making the comparisons between them. You're right that there's a dearth of these things at the moment. There may be forecasts of particular taxes or particular bits of a market or something of this kind from professional agencies, but there isn't much else available apart from the OBR, which forecasts everything that we want to talk about, but on a different basis. So we've got a second one already, if you want to, and I'm sure it's the case in the future, there'll be more. So that's one thing. And the other thing is the deeper economic analysis in the rest of the UK is pushed off from the IFS. There isn't one here. If there were one here, that's likely to be where that would happen. And if you look at Belgium or the Netherlands, I think it's right, that these functions have got split into, they've got separate agencies for doing these things. So they've obviously recognised the point. It's just a question whether the resources available, which is the most efficient way of doing it. It would be nice if other forecasts came from somewhere.
Maybe I could just add a little something to that. So, I think if we did have alternative forecasts, it does obviously provide some additional information. I think it may be slightly overstated how much additional information that would provide, though. So if there were other bodies providing additional forecasts using very similar techniques to those that were used for the official forecast, then they may make different assumptions at different points, there'll be different numbers, but they'll be within the kind of bounds of to which these forecasts vary. What you really want to see is additional information on some aspect of behaviour or some aspect of some development of the economy which is not being captured in the official forecasts or is not being addressed in the methods that underpin the official forecasts. That's the bit that gives you genuinely new information and allows you more fundamental scrutiny of the official forecast.
If, is a concern, one of the concerns you have is obviously having duplicating effort in terms of producing a separate forecast, but I mean, is a primary concern over the fact it would be duplication in itself, or is it a resource issue? I mean, do you think that if you chose to undertake such an exercise as it stands, the Commission wouldn't have the resources to carry that out?
If if we chose or were required to carry out such an exercise, we would resource up in order to be able to do it. We couldn't do it with today's resources. We already have in the financial memorandum the ability to increase our staff to some extent. In our minds, what we would do with that increase in staff would be very much would reflect what Campbell has just said, to really look into some elements more deeply, to understand what is really happening out there, so that we can make a better, more refined judgment about the reasonableness of the official forecast. But if we had to do forecasting, we would simply say to yourselves, we need to resource up to do it. We'd have no hesitation. I mean, that would be, you know, our choice to the extent we needed more resource.
And of course, experience in Ireland was that the Fiscal Council decided to undertake its own forecasting later on, as it developed its own work. And I guess, therefore, that if it transpired there wasn't the additional forecast which you are expecting, then you could at a later point take on that role to a greater extent if you thought it was appropriate at that point.
I think you make an interesting point, because my sense of a number of the IFIs, the independent financial institutions, is that they have evolved over time from their start point. And I would be surprised if we didn't evolve. I don't know that we would evolve in that direction, but I would imagine we would evolve.
My final question then, Convener, thank you very much again for your answers to the panel, is we've talked about the memorandums of understanding, how important they are. You've got an initial one with Revenue Scotland. I mean, at this point, so you've had a lot of meetings with different agencies. Are there any problem areas in terms of accessing information? Are there any departments at the Scottish or UK level of government which you think need to be a bit more receptive to any requests you've made for information, or have broadly you found it to be quite a constructive relationship?
Where we have requested information, you know, broadly, those requests have been met. We are sort of interested, I don't know if concerned is the right word, but we're certainly interested to see how the relationship develops with HMRC. Obviously, the Scottish rate of income tax isn't yet in place, so all we have is anecdote about what that agency may or may not be able to deliver to us, but our understanding is that they're very conscious of the need to deliver data to us in a way which keeps safe under privacy regulation and law what has to be kept safe, just as Revenue Scotland has to do that. So there are some areas that are not tested, but we have not had major issues to date.
Thank you.
Thank you. Jackie, followed by John.
Obviously, forecasting has been explored with you. I'd like to move on to the question of appointments and reports, because I think your independence is absolutely critical in moving forward. Would you accept that you can't really be both an advisor to government and also scrutinise what it does?
Yes. Again, advisor may need a definition so that we are saying the same thing. But we do not conceive of ourselves as advisors to government on policy or whatever. But we do see ourselves as assessors, the body that scrutinizes what government produces. That requires interaction with the government teams.
And I entirely accept that. Yeah. I think I was referring, quite particularly, there were members of the Commission who had a role on the Council of Economic Advisers, and I think there could have been a perception that would have been unfortunate. I gather that position's now changed there.
That position changed. It was actually raised at our appointment hearings, or I'm sorry what the term is, and sort of we took action then to, end our terms with the Council of Economic Advisers, although I could actually say to you there would not have been a conflict, but that's a case of there might be perceived to be one.
Absolutely.
And we wanted to address it.
And perception is all,
everything,
unfortunately.
Yeah.
In terms of appointments, some witnesses have suggested that the powers that ministers wish to have over appointments and, all of that area of work might be excessive and be considered to be, dare I say it, interfering. Do you think they've got the balance of powers right? Or would you, again, in terms of perception, to secure your independence, prefer it to be a relationship more directly with the Parliament?
I would look to both my colleagues to give a view. I mean, we've talked about so many of these issues. At the end of the day, We are answerable to the Parliament. At the end of the day, the Parliament approved our three appointments. We were recommended through a ministerial line, but we were debated, and I read the debate transcript, and actively debated on the floor of the Parliament, and then our appointments were approved. And we are answerable here. I mean, you represent the fuller Parliament, so that's ultimately how we conceive ourselves. But Andrew or Campbell, any other view?
No, I substantially agree with that. I think perhaps only to slightly rephrase your position on that, if I may, I'll do it anyway. And that is, it's not so much the power of the ministers. You're really suggesting whether an alternative appointments committee or something should sit to make the nominations rather than the ministers. And I wouldn't want to intervene on that. I don't think it would make much difference in reality, but the perception may be important.
Could I also say, sorry, am I cutting you off? Okay. Could I also say that as we build in a little bit of a team to help us in our work, and we have started that this over recent months with two part-time research assistants, but we would probably look to some full-time, economist strength, bench strength. We would hire those individuals externally. I mean, we would advertise, we'd have an open process to hire those individuals. So if that is helpful to your thinking.
I think, again, perception is all the fact that ministers control the degree of the appointment process and take powers to themselves to do so, I don't think is helpful to that perception. But let me see if I can manage this question without it being rephrased. Submission of your report. Okay. What's interesting, we have experience, obviously, of public bodies submitting reports to government in advance of publication, technically for checking issues of accuracy. But actually, in practice, issues of presentation have been covered as well. Again, as a perception, in some cases, of government interference in that process. Some witnesses have suggested that actually you shouldn't give them any notice of your report on theirs, and that actually if they're being generous, they should have 24 hours notice to enable them to respond. I would be interested in your view on what you would think would be appropriate, given that the OECD thinks that providing a report in advance favours the government.
Again, we've given a lot of thought to this, and we've heard views from this committee in the past as well. We feel, first of all, so we have done one report, which you were very kindly said you had read, being new to the committee. And in that case, we did submit it because we were told this was the proper thing to do last year for a fact check. And that was very helpful to us. And we continue to think that that is very helpful to us to make sure we've got our facts correct. So there's something in that. We didn't change our findings. We didn't, we weren't concerned that we were offending anyone by doing this, and no one came to us and said, change anything. This was purely a fact check. So there is something about that kind of engagement that can be... The timings are, one can play with the actual timings. So the forecasters could have the forecast essentially done and not to be changed, and they could see our report and correct any facts or suggest facts were different. Or it could be done before the forecast is finalized. We could look at those details. But we think that that is valuable. We think it is hugely valuable to have a series of challenge meetings with the forecasters, because that is really the value that we add, as Campbell has said. That's what we can do. And what we tried to put out in our submission to you was a way to balance what is a bit of a conundrum. How do we get this right? So we proposed, this may or may not be right, we'd happily take some guidance, but we proposed that we have those challenge meetings early in the process. We would go back to the previous year's budget, we'd look at any suggestions we made or criticisms we perhaps had and discuss those. We'd find out what the forecasters were doing in terms of changing or adapting their approach to a forecast, or indeed taking on a new devolved tax, because we'll be facing those relatively soon, and what they're doing. Do that early days, give them our challenges or whatever we give them, which is not advice. We do this, by the way, in the OBR teleconferences we join as well. This seems to be normal practice. And then let the forecasters get on with running their numbers. We wouldn't be part of that because we don't look at the numbers and the outputs. We look at what their thought process is going into it. At the end of the day, we've proposed that we could come out with our report on the budget right at the end of the process. But quite honestly, if we're to add value, there need to be the right points in time to add value. If we simply sit aside, as a think tank might do, and analyze the budget once it comes out, you know, if the budget, I changed my wording here, so forgive me for speaking in slang, but if the budget turned out to be, the draft budget turned out to be rubbish, which I don't think it would, but if it did, surely that does no one any good in the Parliament, and surely it doesn't do the Commission any good, because people would say, well, where were you? So we do need to engage. We need to engage in the right way. That's our thinking just now.
Okay. Can I go back to something? Because I absolutely accept that you look at the processes and the assumptions that are made. But from our perspective, you know, you gave advice on non-domestic rates. The Cabinet Secretary reflected on that, okay, on the assumptions, the modelling, reflected on that, made a change. We've no idea of what he changed it from, you know, and what was wrong with the underlying assumptions. Equally with LBTT, you made a recommendation about behaviour. We don't know what's happened since then, if the Scottish Government have taken that on board or not. So there's almost a bit that doesn't feel transparent about what's happened since you've said what you've said on those issues. And my fear is that the interaction you described that might be quite reasonable amongst reasonable people isn't transparent, and the perception is there's something not quite right there. So, you know, my approach to this is not to make things difficult necessarily, but how do we ensure that your independence is absolutely guarded? That's the most precious thing, I think, here.
Precious thing, and we continue to ponder on how best to do this. But one thought that occurs to me is that when we write our report on the draft budget, we should give you more, or give anyone who reads it more detail. You know, we said, he said, that kind of thing. So that may be helpful in terms of those kinds of movements. But in terms of the change which the minister made. on the economic determinants and, you know, non-domestic rates, we didn't advise on what that change should be or give a parameter. We simply thought that the range from our perspective, our judgment was that it looked somewhat optimistic. So we would, in that case, probably have to have the government spell out as well what it changed from and to, or you would have to speak to the government, I suppose, and ask that question. I don't know, but keep challenging this, because we will get it better and better as we hear those perspectives.
Thank you.
Okay, John, before by Jean.
Hey, thanks, convener. I mean, I suppose to build on this, because you do, I like the word conundrum, which seems fair, and you mentioned that in your written paper and also in your answers to Jackie Bailey. But this whole question of, you know, more interaction might get us to better result, as against less interaction might be perceived as more independent, but we might not end up with the best result. I think my main point on this would be, do we need to have more, some of this in legislation, or can we leave the legislation as it is and there's going to be a memorandum of understanding, or there's just going to be practice, or, you know, how do we put that, all of that, into practice?
I'm not an expert on legislation. I would give my two colleagues a minute to think about how to respond to your question, but my first thought is, in all my professional experience, the more, you know, I think of regulation, which is what I've dealt with so much in my business life, the more restrictive, the more those statements try to anticipate something, the more they omit and don't anticipate the full, you know, the full story. So more general expectations can be enshrined in legislation, but I wouldn't instinctively say we need to become very specific in legislation, because I think ultimately that will have some unintended consequences or omissions. I don't know, but
idea that, I mean, I think your key point is that all minutes would be published. So for you, that would be the way we answer that, in a sense.
Yes, so you'd see what it was that was being discussed and what came to the table, the challenges we raised, and you know, you could see that on an iterative basis. We started taking minutes of those challenge meetings once we had a bit of assistance, which was the beginning of this summer, and we have put summaries of those meetings already on our website. So in essence, we've said we discuss these topics in a challenge meeting. We have the minutes, and with our draft budget report, we will append the full minutes so that those are completely public.
I think I would agree with Susan, but there's also, it's a kind of evolutionary process. If we'll post these minutes, we'll add commentary in our report. If the committee then finds that that's insufficient demonstration of independence or the whole method is still not quite convincing enough, then as an iterative process, we will we'll find something else until it works for everyone's satisfaction. That's the we're here to make it work. So,
and our goal is the same as yours, that we are perceived independent.
Yes. So are we going to say something, Professor Hart? No.
It up and when those minutes come out, if you look at them, you'll see some thoughts, comments as to what the Scottish Government might think of doing next on a particular problem. So it's not just so-and-so said such and such. It's a bit more detailed than that. And second thing is, that's exactly what the Monetary Policy Committee in London does. It puts up the transcripts. I mean, it actually does it, who said what, and this is likely to be a little bit briefer than that, but they actually do, to get the transparency, they do exactly the same thing. They work on the minutes.
I mean, as I understand it, that model is similar to what was happening in Ireland, and Jean Urquhart and I were over in Dublin meeting the Irish Fiscal Advisory Council and others. I think they'd come up against the problem, I think, this year that they were also involved quite early on with a lot of the macroeconomic forecasts. They were not involved in the detail of the budget. But when the budget was announced, there was such a big increase in spending, because the Irish are doing so well, apparently, that was then knocking onto the macroeconomic forecasts. And then there was a bit of a tension between the government and the council as to exactly what was being endorsed. Well, endorsed in their word, reasonable in our words. I mean, is there a potential problem there if you're not involved kind of at the latter stage as the budget's being prepared?
It depends on the forecasting methods that are being employed, whether they, if there's a big regime change, if there's a big change in tax policy that no one has discussed up until that point, then there could be behavioural consequences, and if the modelling isn't taking account of that, then it's quite late in the day for us to then intervene to factor in that effect.
So your argument would be the model should be robust enough to cover these different scenarios?
That's the ideal situation, yes.
Yes. Okay, fair enough. I think just a couple of other points. I mean, again, partly because I was over in Ireland myself, when they also moved from a non-statutory to a statutory basis, and I think were somewhat taken aback at the amount of admin, HR policy, health and safety, you know, all of these kind of things which fall in once you're a statutory body, because although you're a small statutory body, you've got a lot of the same responsibilities as a big statutory body. Is that something you're aware of and you've taken into account?
Very much aware of that, and we have been thinking about that and beginning to have discussions and give some shape to a transition team or a transition board, which would be supported out of the civil service. So there would be a team that would actually take us through all the stages. We would go onto a statutory footing on 1st April 2017, so from now we have about 16, 17 months, whatever it is. But we feel we need to get ourselves well ready, well before that. And what I mean by that is we understand that the keeper of the records, I think is the title, or the office, that we have to keep records of all of our exchanges, emails, notes, everything. Now, as a banker, I'm quite used to that, but we are trying to put in place, or have put in place now, processes to maintain those records. So we want to get ourselves into those good habits well ahead of time. But we will need a risk register. I assume we will need to have our own finances audited. We will need to do all of those things. We've started having right now over this year, quarterly, what we call governance meetings, although we discuss these things more frequently, but those meetings are to discuss those governance issues. So we're trying to anticipate both to plan what we need to do over the next year plus, but also put a number of those things in place now, so we're ready. We also understand we have to have an accountable officer, and we have talked about my suggestion of a title, so it may change or not, but a chief of staff, but a senior individual whom we would hire, again, hire ourselves, if you see what I mean, advertise for the post. And I would look to that individual also to keep us right in terms of those matters. But I wouldn't underestimate the amount of time that all of that takes. At the same time, those matters are important and we would undertake them.
Okay, that's fair. And the final area I touched on in your letter, the final paragraph's about resources. And you talk about, future, if your remit expands, you'll have to commit more time. And then leading on to the resources available to it will need to grow prudently to support the additional work. I mean, we have had some suggestion that we are funding the Scottish Fiscal Commission quite generously when we compare to Ireland, which has full range of responsibilities, and also Sweden. I mean, are you anticipating that your budget might not be sufficient?
No, a few comments there. One is that the budget partly is built on an assumption of this government's pay rates for, if we have two or three or one full-time economists, let's say, that pay rate comes from this government. That may be different in other countries. The budget proposed also anticipates the potential need that we might have to go into fully commercial office space. For instance, right now we, as you know, are being hosted in our non-statutory phase by the University of Glasgow very generously. So it anticipates some additional costs. But I would also point out, and I don't know, I read your write-up from the visit to IFAC in Ireland, where it points out that they have half a dozen or eight secondees. The note didn't say whether these were carried in their own budget, whether they came from government or what. The OBR, certainly Robert Choate, has been very open with this committee in talking about the number of people in government at the UK level who provide data and information and support the work of the OBR. So I wouldn't want to say that the budget that's proposed is right, wrong, generous or not. It depends what that encompasses. Could I also just assure you that, and we have had this conversation and we're in absolute agreement, that we would have no intention of spending up to a budget. A budget isn't there to be spent. The budget is there to allow us to grow and develop as we see fit. And in this very, incredibly important moment as we go from non-statutory to a statutory footing, we wouldn't go out and hire four full-time economists, if that was allowed in the budget. We might hire one if we feel we need another, or as new taxes come in, we might need to add to that. And to answer an earlier question, if we found we suddenly had much expanded responsibilities, we might have to come back and say it's not enough. But we certainly would not today say it's not enough. We think it's a very fair budget and does give us some scope for making our own independent decisions about how and in what ways to expand.
Thank you.
Thank you. Just very, very quickly, really, having, as John Mason said, the Irish experience, was very interesting. Two things come to mind. First of all, smaller country, but in the Eurozone, and of course independent, and with different. And you're right to say that the staff, my memory was that actually they were all seconded. One from the central bank and so on for a period of time, so that the staff were changing as well, but came with different experience, and that was interesting. But of course, they did have five members of IFAC, and I wonder whether that's something that you've thought about too, that three people is... Is that under discussion? Do you think about that going forward? And further to that, you mentioned earlier on today in an answer to a question that about the pool being very small. That was also a discussion in Ireland. And four of their five commissioners live abroad, although they're Irish. And that was a bit of a revelation to me. I mean, suddenly we were looking internationally and knowing that
the Scottish diaspora is even bigger than the Irish diaspora, that there may be expertise around the globe that we might want to encourage. And you did say earlier on that with 13, 14 universities in Scotland, that, you know, that there was plenty of expertise for people who would step into your shoes. And I just wondered if you would address that question, whether there really are the people that, again, perception being everything, I mean, three of you are very high profile and so on, is there really that pool available in Scotland?
My colleagues may have anecdotal views, being academics themselves and knowing their peers. We haven't sat down as a commission and said, who would those likely people be? But there is something about the governance of succession and succession planning, and that should become part of our conversation. So in a way, your question is a good trigger in that direction. Should there be more than three of us as members of the commission? It seems to me two would be too few. And there is always the number 27 bus risk. So there might be, a thought about increasing our number. But we, all of us, are quite prudent in saying, let's grow in anticipation. Our view is let's grow as we need to, as we become bigger, as we go into statute, if we need to grow. So I wouldn't be surprised if we spoke to this committee at some point and said, look, we do think we need another commissioner, whose term would then be staggered, who would gain the experience and the knowledge that was needed to keep all of this going. But in terms of is the pool out there or not, I think you occasionally talk to some other academics who might well be considered candidates if they were interested in something like this. But we haven't determined who those might be or how big the pool is.
Thank you. I would, picking up on all of that, not disagree at all. I would, if we're thinking about having four instead of three or something of this kind, I would, rather than fix on a particular number, I would fix on particular expertise and skills. So there's a comparative advantage within the commission at the moment. That's working fine. But keep an eye on that. So we certainly talked about that. Going international, the diaspora point, it's not just Ireland. A lot of these commissions do that. So that's not, from my perspective, not an issue. That's fine. The too few expertise, there's always a too small a pool, there's always a problem. There's plenty of people out there, and the question is whether you actually want them. It's a question of what kind of people are out there. And that might be a bit more restrictive, it depends.
And whether they would want to take
on
this
might,
role.
No, they might not want to do it, yeah. I mean, certainly in the Swedish example, I mean, I know quite a lot about these things. In the Swedish example, the original chairman walked out in a huff because it was taking too much time. He wanted to publish a few academic papers at the same time. I sympathise enormously. So some people might not want to do it. So it's a bit of a tricky thing.
Okay, and just finally, I'm sorry that time's moving on, but while you don't see yourself producing, duplicating work that's been done in a full forecast and so on, but selecting particular pieces of work, I mean, would you say that the change in LBTT from old stamp duty and the kind of figures that we've got at the moment, that merit the kind of work that you would home in on to see whether that, I mean, it's quite a small part overall of the budget, but it's quite an important one. And I can see that there are kind of government policies which come through into these kind of forecasts. How would you deal with drilling down into or looking more comprehensively at any one particular part of the forecasting and avoid or ignore government policy that will actually have a determinant on the outcome?
Go ahead.
Yeah. So I think in our initial report, there's I think several instances where we suggest that kind of the behavioural effects of policy, it would be best if these could be incorporated somehow into the method of producing the forecast. So I would argue that the kind of analysis that we could do is essentially to analyse these kind of behavioural effects, and then you build up a model, you build up a piece of analysis, and whatever the policy happens to be, you feed it through that model. So it's kind of ready to do the policy analysis that you need it to do.
There may be other factors as well, not just government policy changes, but if you look at mortgages, regulation over the last year has made the mortgage application process much more rigorous, particularly for first-time homebuyers than ever before. There's a lot of debate going on whether that's too much, so that will affect the number of people who can qualify for a mortgage completely outside government policy. So it's important to look at all those factors, the external ones as well.
Yeah, so it's a bit, if there's any kind of break in the economic conditions that underpin an extrapolation of historical data, then it's behavioural responses you're starting to look at to those changes.
A little bit. You're quite right about priorities, setting the priorities, which taxes to look at and so on, which is, and there are different sizes, so I would put more weight on the bigger ones, and I would also insist that the errors, when we quote them, if we quote them, not only in percentages, but also in pounds, so you see what bang they're going to have on the budget, as it were. That helps prioritise quite considerably, so I hope we do that in the future. And for this sort of thing, I also think it's important to avoid implicitly commenting on the underlying policies. That's to say, you take them as is, for now. If you're told for sure next year we're going to put this tax up or something, then you might be able to do that because that's a public announcement that's been made. But otherwise, we don't want to be in the position which we've said this forecast rubbish because everybody knows this tax rate's going to go up or down or something, which is why we got a slightly delayed effect on the forestalling, which is a case in point. You know, it's only when it actually comes in you're able to do something about saying how much effect will this have in pounds terms, and even then it's somewhat uncertain. But it's important to do it at that point, but not second guess ahead of time.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mark.
Thank you, Mayor. I just wanted to very briefly on the forecasting issue, just to get my head around where we are, because obviously we've had the evidence that, and I think Lady Rice, you've very helpfully tried to disaggregate between what you call the sort of the capital F and the small F forecasting, which I think is a helpful analogy to draw. I mean, when you're undertaking your work, presumably the work you're doing involves a degree of modelling that essentially replicates elements of the forecasting method in order to test the robustness of forecasts without sort of beginning at the beginning and ending at the end of the forecasting process. Would that be a fair assessment of the work that you're doing?
Well, there's a mixture of things. So we kind of go through the nitty-gritty of the methods that the Scottish Government are using. We're also undertaking, as I've said, a series of projects which are looking at things which are just not contained within the methods that are being used as well. So it's not just replicating an element of the forecast, it's looking at something that's off-model as far as the Scottish Government's concerned, to see whether that's an influence, that's a factor that maybe should be taken account of but currently isn't. So it's a mixture of, you know, step-by-step analysing what's actually being done and looking at other issues off forecast which maybe should be taken account of but aren't currently being taken account of. So it's a mixture of those.
And also in terms of the independence point or the separation between yourselves and Scottish Government. I mean, some of the perception that there has been is of you essentially sort of looking over the shoulder and, you know, saying, "Are you sure about that?" How involved or otherwise do you think you need to be in order for your challenge, essentially the challenges that you would put forward, to be one, taken seriously, but also done in such a way that it ensures that the information that is laid before Parliament is as robust as it needs to be?
I guess I would answer that question by saying it's not really our job to ensure that the information laid before Parliament is as robust as it could be. It's the government's job. They're laying the information before Parliament. So we're not saying, here, you must do this, but we're suggesting, have you looked at these factors? You know, we think this might have a big impact. The Scottish Government can take these on board or not. It's their choice at the end of the day. If they produced a forecast which, in our judgment, was not particularly robust, we would say that, and they would have laid a non-robust forecast in front of you. But I don't think it's our job to ensure that they do their job. We would have a different role spec if that was the case.
Sure, I appreciate that. I mean, Ian Leonard, who has done some work around comparisons, etc., has suggested that exertion of influence over forecasts changes the kind of definition from independent assessor to advisor. Would you suggest that what you perceive your role to be maintains that independent assessor role rather than becoming an advisor? Because to me, an advisory role is very, very much more heavily involved and directing what happens, or at least having a role in direction of what happens rather than challenge. But
yes, we would expect the teams to be accountable in some way or answerable to us about why they did or didn't take any advice we gave them. We're not in that kind of relationship with them. We operate, and again, I would say what I said before, this is really absolutely the way the OBR operates. It has a series of challenge meetings. It produces some tables, some data. This is our thinking so far, speaks to key individuals in these meetings who raise questions and challenges and whatever, and they go off and do some more work. We're doing the same thing here. That's what we do.
My way of work, what I'm used to as an academic economist, is the academic seminar. So someone presents their work and you interrogate them while they do that. It's not always comfortable for the person presenting their work. You go through it line by line. You make very critical comments and it toughens up what they do, and that's the model I have in mind. When we then go and do our own independent pieces of research, we would release those as technical working papers, present them to interested audiences as well, and go through the same process ourselves of the academic seminar, and you know, come and get us, see what we've done, kick holes in it if you can.
Okay.
As I said a long time back, how you approach it is motivated by, would I do the same? Would I do something different? At that point, you can suggest, have you thought about looking at this variable or this factor which has got left out? It is up to them to decide. They may well come back. If we have this extended PERDA period, which we're not talking to, this may be more difficult, but they would come back and say, we tried that and it didn't work. And there are a number of things we've picked on in different forecasting models they're using where we're not come to a complete end of trying this and trying that and all the rest of it. But it's entirely up to them as to whether they try it or whether they come back or not. So it's, the motivation from our side is, would I do the same? Which is, what you're doing in a seminar. If you go to beyond that stage, then you do get more heavily involved. And as I said earlier in the general peroration on forecasting, you then find your independence is compromised. So that's why I think it's not a good idea to be doing that. And most of these kind of commissions have come to the same conclusion. They have these sort of backup calculations, if you like. They don't produce the official forecasts.
Okay.
Thank you very much. That's concluded questions from the committee. I've got three or four still to ask. Oh, Joel. I think it's been a very long session. I do appreciate your involvement and your concentration and the clarity of your answers. Anything further you wish to add before we wind up the session?
I don't think so. No, this has been very useful, as all these conversations are, but nothing else. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much. And no doubt we'll see you at the committee again before too long. Okay, at the start of the meeting, the committee agreed to take the next item in private. I therefore would like to close the public part of the meeting to enable witnesses in the official report in public to leave. I'm just going to call a 1-minute recess so we can go straight on to the final piece of business in private.